That will be joining us and the kind of insights we'll be hearing as we listen to them as well as our organizers today. But what we're going to start with this evening is something that's definitely going to bring a smile to many of your faces. We're going to start with a small dance by the children from the Smile Foundation. So a big warm welcome for them.
इंतजार था आज की शाम का अब देखो क्या करता है ये बंदा हिंदुस्तान का जो किसी के भी आगे झुका नहीं हाँ मैं हूँ उस देश का
रंग केसर शूरा वाणिया रंग सब्ज खिली फुलकारिया ओ रंग चिट्टा नियत साफ तो ओ रंग तीनों जान से प्यारे रंग तीनों जान से प्यारे
रंग मेरी माई का रंग सच्चाई का हर अच्छाई का है माए माए माए
रंग तेरी रीत का रंग तेरी प्रीत का रंग तेरी जीत का ही छाए कैसे मैं चुकावा तेरा एहसान माए तेरी चूनरी लहराए
जब तक मुझ में है जरा सी जान माए तेरी चूनरी
Right, and now I'd like to invite the man behind it all, and many of you know him very well. He's someone who's an achiever in his own right and has been able to recognize the need in this space and the fact that the knowledge, the skill set, the network that he has cultivated over the years can be something that he can take forward and really make a difference. He works around the clock. He always has more than enough on his plate. And I would really like you to give a huge hand of applause to Karan Gupta, the man behind KGEC, to tell us a little bit more about the foundation and IE.
Thank you very much, Ava. You're too kind. So, good evening and a very warm welcome to I Am Woman, an evening dedicated to recognizing the strength, wisdom, and grace of women. My name is Karan Gupta, and I will speak for 5 minutes, okay? So, this event is an initiative of IE Business School and the Karan Gupta Education Foundation. Both these organizations recognize the important roles that women play in our lives, at home, in school, in business, and in the government. Every single woman has a story to tell, a vision of a brighter future for herself and the people around her. We recognize the barriers that women face and wish to support their professional, academic, and personal goals in any way that we can. This is demonstrated by IE Business School's introduction of hashtag IE Women last month. This is a 6 million euro scholarship fund with the objective of promoting career development and leadership skills to women in various fields of study. IE Women also supports a mentoring program between female students, alumni, and professionals because, as author Harriet Stowe once said, women are the real architects of society. There is great value in mentorship and in education, and IE Business School wishes to foster the amazing outcomes that can arise when women work together and support one another. Karan Gupta Education Foundation shares the same values. Our mission is to provide education, training, and skills to the underprivileged, especially women and children. In our 18 years of service, we have provided education, career guidance, and training to thousands of students, and with nearly 90% of them being women. Most recently, we conducted a mobile training course for handicapped people and people with leprosy. Instead of weaving baskets all their lives, they now have paying jobs and the skills needed to build their own careers. And in thinking about the work that we've done in the last 1 year, one particular student stands out in my memory. On a bright and sunny morning, I arrived at my office to find a young girl waiting by the door. She was physically challenged, and all her life, society had instilled the idea in her that she was not good enough, not smart enough, not strong enough. Upon seeing the success of our mobile repairing program, she found the courage inside herself to prove society wrong. She came to me, asked me to participate in the program, asking me if she can participate in the program. I saw the determination in her eyes and immediately welcomed her. She was able to access the strength and ability that she possessed all along and completed the training successfully. And now, not only does she have a successful career, but a sense of self-reliance that can never be taken from her. It's stories like this and stories like the ones we will hear tonight which make my work worthwhile. This is our second year of I Am Woman, and I am most excited to be sharing this evening with you. The power women who inspired us last year have achieved even greater heights of success, and we look forward to seeing that same growth in the women being recognized here tonight. Whether they're shaping the future of the film industry like Krishika Lulla, inspiring young women in entrepreneurship like Farah Ali, teaching women that even your hobby can become a successful career like Miss Malini, teaching the next generation of students like Shaheen Mistry, or advocating for transgender youth like Gauri Sawant, every single woman being recognized here has a story to tell. Our chief guest tonight, Mrs. Amruta Fadnavis, has adopted villages and still works as a banker, encouraging women to work even after marriage. And I'll never forget the words of acid attack survivor Laxmi Agarwal, who said, "Usne mera chehra badla hai, dil nahi." As she works towards changing the perception of women in India. Through the experiences that our women share tonight, you would undoubtedly be inspired by their strength, courage, and compassion. We wish to recognize these women's amazing achievements, but also to encourage and inspire every person here. We hope that each and every one of you will not only listen, but truly feel what these women have gone through and how they have overcome adversity and achieved what they set out to do. We hope that you in turn inspire those around you and let this sense of empowerment spread like wildfire. In this way, we can all have a real impact on our communities and the world at large. Allow me to conclude with Helen Reddy's song. I am woman, hear me roar. In numbers too big to ignore. If I have to, I can do anything. I am strong. I am invincible. I am woman. Thank you.
Thank you, Karan. So I'd like to kickstart by welcoming our first guest this evening onto stage, Krishika Lulla. She's a producer, Eros Entertainment, and one of India's youngest and most successful movie producers. Over the last few years, She has created several successful films, many of which we've loved, including Ram Leela and several women-centric ones, in fact, like Ranjana, NH10, and Tanu Weds Manu. Krishika, thanks for joining us. I'm going to go on and complete the intro, though, as there are so many fantastic things to say. She's also forayed into the making of regional cinema, and also, while producing movies, she has extended her entrepreneurial skills beyond films as an active member of the women's wing of the IMC, and has recently unveiled, has been unveiled as the face of leading jewelry brand Jet Gems, which has described her as the epitome of what a woman achiever should aspire for today. Thank you once again. Malini Agarwal. Malini is, of course, the founder and creative director of Miss Malini Entertainment, and I'm sure all of you are very familiar with her as well, a leading new media network that creates highly engaging multi-platform content geared towards India's internet generation. Malini is India's first and most famous celebrity blogger and social media personality. She's pioneered Indian lifestyle blogging, and you all, of course, have been addicted to MissMalini.com, I think, since about 2008. The website today reaches over 4 million organic monthly visitors from over 200 countries, more than 80% of which are women, and Malini is also a regular speaker on CMO forums. Shaheen, Mistry, social activist and educator, and... for those of you who are not well-versed yet with the story, as a young college student, Shaheen walked into the Mumbai slums expressing her desire to teach less privileged children who roam the streets. To fulfill this, she founded the Akanksha Foundation, a non-profit organization in education, at the age of 20 to impact the lives of such children. Over two decades, her foundation, which started with just 15 children, has now reached 3,500 children in 58 centers and 6 schools. And let me also welcome Farah Khan Ali. Great to have you with us, Farah. Please join us on stage. Renowned jewelry designer, gemologist, she can be called a jewel alchemist as well. Known for translating beautiful imagery and thoughts into exquisite gems, worn, of course, by international celebrities and at red carpets around the world. Farah is also, of course, actively involved in missions such as the Antarctic Treaty to preserve the Antarctica and, of course, our planet, and also in recycling and many other such initiatives. Thank you, Farah. All right, let me also join them now. So I think one of the main reasons that we're all here today is purely because the success of some of these women, all of you, and many of you who are here with us as well in the audience, is an inspiration to so many youngsters out there today. And what they always want to know, from achievers like yourself, is really where to begin, and a little bit of an insight from your stories. You know, what was the driving force that brought you to where we are today, to the fact that you've become beacons in your own right? So let me start with you, Krishika.
Good evening, everyone. It's wonderful to be here in front of all you esteemed people. Talking about my journey and my success, I feel a little weird, but still. what I feel and I believe is because of my will and determination, I'm here. I've also faced a lot of hurdles and setbacks. I never thought, it just started as a thought that culminated into this beautiful dream. I was a very shy, introvert girl. I never thought I would be able to do something like this. Yes, it took a lot of courage. To break through my fears, especially coming in this field, It was like to hear a no many times. Whether initially I had to hear a no from a director, from an actor, many times. So it took a while for me to really be there and to believe in myself and to hear a no and still go ahead. And that's how I started my journey.
Fantastic. Malini, let me get your thoughts as well. And you know, also take off from something Krishika said, which is that it's important to recognize that everyone has failures, or if not failures, challenges along the way that they do need to bridge.
Yeah, absolutely. First of all, thank you so much for having me here. It's a real honor. And it's really inspiring to be with so many amazing women on the stage. I guess for me, my journey, I never really started out thinking I'm going to build, a digital empire or any like that. I was really blogging for passion. I love to write, and I've done different things, whether it was running digital content or being a backup dancer for Sukhbir or being in the radio. And I always felt that the one thing that connected me with people were my words or my voice. And that's really what I was trying to do. And I think the one thing, like you said, what is it that people can do? How can they succeed, or how do they find what their dream is? I think it's really find that passion. And I say this very often that, you know, before you try to become rich and famous, think about the one thing that you would do for the rest of your life, even if no one paid you to do it. And then do that. Pursue that as your career. And I'm sure all the women on the stage will agree that the universe will conspire to make you successful at it. And I think that's what I encourage all the women and the boys to find the thing you're passionate about. We actually live in an amazing time where you can make literally anything your career, careers that never existed, you know, even 10 years ago. So I'm excited for everyone who's, you know, the millennials who want to do something today.
Fantastic. Let me come to you, Shaheen, and understand, because you're also, you know, sort of started off in a very difficult space. I'm assuming. Tell us a little bit about your journey and, you know, the set of challenges that you had perhaps were a little different from, let's say, somebody who was striving in the corporate world or in the world of fashion or movies, for example. So give us your perspective.
Sure. It's such a good question. Like, what would you share with somebody else? I think being able to hold the truth and the hope. So the truth is that I'm getting an award today. And the truth is that I'm educating through Teach for India, where I work 42,000 kids today. The truth is also that there are 320 million kids in India, most of whom don't get an excellent education. So I think being able to hold both of those, and then there's the hope, and I feel incredibly blessed to do the work that I do, since it's all about women today. A quick story. One of my students, Priyanka, lived in a slum community in Pune. Her father's in jail for life. He escaped. He married four other women. He had seven other children. She grew up with tremendous instability, and that girl just wanted to do something with her life. And so she came into Teach for India. She got into the United World College in Italy. She graduates from there this year. She's just got a full scholarship into Franklin Marshall in the US. That's not the incredible part of the story. The hope is that she, last year in her summer holidays, brought 10 of her friends from Italy, they were from all over the world, to India to live in her home in the slum and do community work. So that idea of how do you find your potential, but how do you spread it? How is education about being our best, but how is it about making the world better? And I think just being obsessed with whatever you want to do, right? And I think that probably speaks for everyone on this panel. We're just sort of obsessed with what we do. That, I think, would be my advice.
Yeah. That's so interesting, because it's a recurring theme, I think. You know, Malini mentioned passion, obsession, and, you know, Krishika also mentioned just drive and the fact that you just need to constantly be at it. What do you think, Farah?
I have to first say thank you all for having me here. And yes, I agree with all these three wonderful women here. It's very important in life to have passion, creativity, and drive. And I think that's what actually happened to me, because I'm the kind of person that if I want to do something, I do 100% or I don't do it at all. And so I never planned to be a jewelry designer. I actually planned to go to LA and party. And I decided that if I'm going to go party, I have to do 100% of it. So I convinced my parents that I wanted to do jewelry design because a friend of mine was going and I needed an excuse to go to LA. But when I landed in LA, I opened my books and I had a heart attack because gemology is not jewelry design. Gemology is actually a science and jewelry design is artistic. So here I was, way neck deep into work that was math, science, all the subjects I hated in school, and I was like, now what? But I broke those fears and I actually said, okay, I'm now 100% going to study. So instead of becoming this party animal I hoped to be, I became the Indian nerd. And I put 100% of my work into my study. That paid off because I topped my class and I came back to India and I had all this knowledge and I was like, now what? And I started interning with various jewelers and various people because my parents believed that they had given me an education as my legacy and I need to build it on my own. It wasn't like, darling, let me fund you and let me open a store for you. So I had to work it all by myself. So I actually worked from ground level and built my life. It's been a long journey of 25 years up until 3 years ago, almost 4 years ago. I lost everything I started off with because I trusted too many people and I was just a jewelry designer before that. I ended up being in court for 6 months in a litigation with someone who took me to court to prevent me from using my own brand name because he was a partner in my company. So I restarted my life. Those 6 months in court were the best lessons I learned and I decided that now I need to relearn what I had learned. So from just a jewelry designer, I became a businesswoman and I became a lawyer and a banker and an accountant and everything that I never was. So I thank the guy who took me to court and I think that you learn the best from failure. And I have learned so much from failure that now the only way is up. And after I split with him, I opened my own manufacturing company. And I actually started working with Tanish, India's largest retail chain. And that wouldn't have happened to me if I hadn't split with my partners. So all good things happen from bad things. And that's what's common between all of us is we're all passionate about what we do. And I don't love to design. I live to design. So I think it's my passion that's brought me here and what I actually share with people. Thank you.
Thank you. So I want to ask all of you, you know, when we are talking about pushing ourselves, that's one thing. But, you know, like you said, Shaheen, and there are girls that you work with that you're an inspiration for, that you motivate, that you push. When it came to yourselves, and you all started so young, right, all of you, who were the driving forces in your life? I mean, to what extent do you feel that that motivation needs to be within, and to what extent do you feel that we also need external sources of support, whether it be an institution or family or partners? You know, I just want to get your thoughts on that, Malini.
I mean, so obviously you have a lot of people that support you, and you may not even realize the ones that have taught you so many things. Just like Farah said, you know, you have so many mentors, whether they're older siblings or people that you've worked with. For me, I was really lucky that, one, my mother, you know, as cliche as it sounds, she would always be there front and center. Whenever I was even dancing on stage, she'd be there with a little video camera filming only me and cutting off everyone else's heads, you know? Because she was just that proud and supportive, even though, you know, technically I'm a girl dancing on stage behind, you know, a singer, which may not have been okay with so many people. So she was always like a huge support. I had some amazing mentors through my entire career here where they wouldn't stop me from like, oh, well, you know, you're a nerd, so you can't write interesting other content. And for instance, Cyrus Oshidar, who I worked with at MTV, he was like, I used to work in the .com section. He's like, what do you do here? And I was like, oh, I run, you know, on the website. He goes, do you want to write shows? Without even checking whether I had the experience or not. You know, so people who give you the opportunity. My husband, Nashad, who's sitting there and filming right now. So we started dating before he was going off to business school. He went to Harvard Business School. And everyone told me, oh, he's never going to come back. We did 2 years long distance, and he heard about this whole .com boom happening. And when he came back, so we obviously, you know, when you're in a relationship, you will, you know, both have salaries and everything. And I really wanted to do this, but I wasn't going to make any money. So we were just about engaged, and he said, you know what, I'll support us. You go like jile apni zindagi simran. And it was just so great that, you know, there was no demand or no expectation. It was just like, you know what, I'm going to make it possible for you to dive in and do something without saying, well, you know, most people be like, what's the purpose of it? Is it going to make money? Is it not? But with so much love and support. So, I mean, that's kind of the reason we should give him a round of applause. And platforms, you know, that even, for instance, platforms like this, that encourage more women and that put us in the spotlight. Like, you know, everyone here works so hard. Like, maybe 5% of our lives are at all in that glamorous space. Nobody realized how much hard work is involved. So, but for people to, you know, acknowledge that the way that is happening here or various other stages also is a huge enabler. So I think there's many people like
Farah.
I want to add to what Malini said. It's true. For me, my parents have been my greatest support. Because my parents always encouraged us to empower women and to break the mindset. You need the backing of your parents right from a young age. And unlike most mothers, my mother never said, oh, you're my princess, and you know, you have to grow up and look beautiful, and you have to dress like this, and you have to marry this person and this. You know, because women are brought up all the time by their mothers, teaching them to look beautiful and only marry rich men and make their lives. And my mother always said to me, never think you're the most beautiful woman in the world, because there are 100 million women better looking than you. And she used to say to me, I want you to work and I want you to support yourself and make something out of your life. And so thank you, Mom, for that support. She's here right now and she's my superstar. She's my woman of substance. And I think that's what changed it all for my sisters, whether it's my sister Simone or my sister Suzanne or myself. We're all working women. And I think our example was my mother, who used to work. So we weren't brought up to think that we were gorgeous and drop dead and we should look for Prince Charming. We were brought up to look, we were brought up to be humanitarian, have kindness, compassionate, be sensitive, do charity, help people. And I think that's what's important as women. So my mother was a great support system to me on that front. My dad taught me to be fearless, to speak my mind, to speak the truth, no matter if the world is against you, stand up. Do not bow down. And I think that's what actually gets me into these controversies on Twitter sometimes and social media, because I actually speak my heart and I actually say what it is. I'm not trying to powder someone up or live up to someone's just because the world thinks that they're God, that I need to be subservient to them. So I speak my mind. So thank you to my dad and my mom for giving me that. And I am who I am because... And I think every woman is, we have the confidence only to be who we are because of our upbringing. So that's there. Thank you.
And I think that's why we're all here today as well, because it clearly is education and upbringing that's going to be instrumental in changing the generation that's coming up next. Krishika, what are your thoughts? You know, how important is the elimination of that fear factor, that then allows people or youngsters today to go out there and be a lot more confident in achieving their dreams?
As I said before, it takes a lot of courage.
Just hold it closer a little bit.
It takes a lot of courage to be where I am today. So, of course, my family values has also kept me so strong that wherever I go and whatever I'm exposed to, I'm grounded and I know what I'm doing. It's not that, you know, my head is always on my shoulders and I'm grounded. I've also faced a lot of problems, like when I started the film Ranjana, like my film in my own colleagues, they said, what am I doing? I think she's here to just waste money or something. And actually, my husband stood by me and like he says, no problem, I believed in you and I've done this. Now, I don't know. You have to face the facts. I was like nervous, and because I had seen his work and the way people spoke to me that time, I felt I think I've done something wrong or I've taken a wrong step. But still, I went ahead and I believed in myself. And as the trailer was released, like I had all my colleagues come up to me and they said, sorry, what we spoke. And I just got to know. I never told them that I knew what you spoke about me at that time. So they said, they just saw the trailer and they said, fantastic trailer and you've done a brilliant job and we're very proud of you. It made me feel so overwhelmed that, okay, I'm doing something right, and especially to know that my husband is there with me and he's been very supportive. At many times, I did feel that, okay, now I just can't feel this man's world. Every now and then, they keep telling you something or the other. But still, I'm in a struggle. I'm still struggling because I've made around 11 to 12 films I've produced. Maybe one film has not done well. So it looks like my journey is again started, and I yet have to prove myself from the beginning, from where I've started. So I'm right now I'm at that stage, starting again, trying to prove what I'm doing. My next will bring me back to where I am.
And it's so important to recognize that, there are so many levels to a journey, and that it doesn't really end because there's always going to be the next step. And for an achiever, there really is no limit in sight. The sky is always the limit, isn't it? Shaheen, let me get your thoughts.
I think my greatest lessons have been from my kids. Last week, I was very nervous. I was going to visit a general ward in the hospital because one of our kids had been playing cricket. He stumbled, he hit a electric wire. And got a terrible current and had to have his arm amputated. And so I went there thinking, what do you say to a 12-year-old child who a week before has had his arm amputated? And I walked into the general ward and I see this child, Ramesh, sitting up in bed playing Jenga with his right hand, with his Teach for India teacher next to him, smiling away. His mother smiling by his side. The child tells me the whole story of what happens and then starts to just show so much gratitude to us, to Teach for India, to the fact that the family isn't alone, that we're there with him. And I was thinking, like, how incredible, right? How incredible. And his mother, like, talking to me and thanking me when this a week before had happened to her child. And I think for me, that's been amazing. It's made me question a lot, who are the people who have a lot and who are the people who don't have a lot? And how can I learn every single minute and second from my kids every day? I mean, I had a six-year-old come and ask for a meeting with me. And we met at a coffee shop. And he had actually baked brownies halfway through. Half of them had fallen down, so he had to rebake the brownies. And he'd raised a few thousand rupees, and he wanted to donate them, so he had a lot of questions to ask about Teach for India. And then I met another child that day who doesn't have a lot of money, but he's very interested in art, and so he's sculpting chalk pieces. And he's made a whole chessboard out of chalk. And when he saw I was interested, every day I get a WhatsApp picture of a new chalk sculpture that he makes. So, I mean, it's unbelievable what our kids have and what we can learn from them.
So much joy in that, yeah. You know, I often actually interact with a lot of women in the corporate world, and I'm bringing that up again because a constant debate over there is the issue of femininity in the workplace. And when I'm sitting here with these lovely ladies today, it really seems to be an irrelevant question because you're all so much at ease with yourselves as women. You know, there's beauty, there's grace, and you embrace that. I want to understand, you know, from you whether in your own unique fields, you do face any kind of sexism at the workplace. You mentioned a little bit, Krishika, in terms of challenges as a young producer, but do you think things would have been different if you were, if you were a man?
I would say definitely, because I do feel it's still a man's world, especially in this field. It's not that, now it's getting better, and people are realizing, because we can see all the technicians from in all our field, whether it's a director or whether it's cameraman or camera woman. So it's definitely getting better. But I would say there are different fields where you can't stop these things happening, like whatever we've heard recently also. So these things do happen. It's, as a woman producer, yes, of course, there were older men, as in, I would not take names. They were directors, they were different kind of actors. They thought that I'm like very, you know, because I love to dress up. As a woman, we all are fashionable and we all like to be the way we want to be. So they thought that it's like very easy, you know, like to talk to her and to get all the things done very easily. I was like, really? I couldn't tell this to my husband, because if I would have told this to my husband that I'm facing such issues, I think till now he does not know this. Because I didn't want to go back to him, oh, this happened to me today. I have taken the step, and willingly, and yes, it took a lot of courage for me to deal with it on my own without even telling a word to him. How these people have tried to talk to me, and you know the way they hug you, you know, a woman can come to know the feeling, so that how they hug you and they say hello to you. And then after some time I started giving them, like, you know, giving them back on my own, and very, like, whoever I met, there was a very funny incident, but I don't know if I could share this.
Well, you have to now.
There was a man, I mean, like, it took a while for me to be courageous. There was a man who came. I was, like, with my friends and all, and, like, he was, like, he came up to me and, like, he tried. I didn't know he was a director, and I didn't know him at all. So I work with very few limited people. I'm happy with them because I can interact with them, and I know their mind space, and I don't know what kind of subject I want to work with. I do not deal with slapstick kind. I do not deal with horror films. I know what I want, and I deal with those directors. So this guy, he came up to me and he just, like, tried to hug me. I was in my space. I just pushed him, actually pushed him so hard that he fell. So it was, and my husband said, you should just walk away. I said, at that spur moment, like, you know, I was like fed up somewhere. Ki, enough is enough. Yeah. I won't take it anymore.
Well, good for you.
Thank you.
Farah, let me get your take. I know you said you weren't brought up to believe that you were, you know, God's gift, but I'm sure you've faced some...
Well, ever since I was growing up, I have this... I don't know, people used to call me Feisty Farah, Fiery Farah. So, I would say I've been lucky because no man has actually tried to get the better of me, because if they did, God would help them, because I would really get the better of them. But I empower, you know, empowering a woman doesn't only mean empowering yourself. I have women at my workspace and I'm the boss, so I actually teach the women who work for me to be confident, to be strong. I tell my employees that they can call me 24/7. I have my mobile on, and that I would drop everything and be there for them in the middle of the night, be it at the police station or at the hospital, because for me, my workers are my team, and I have to look after them, whether it's their male workers and their wives or whether it's just women working for me. So for me, empowering... the people who I interact with and my staff is really important, and I also believe I also teach them, like she said, women like to dress up, and we dress up not just to entice a man, because that's not what we want to do. We dress up to feel good. So I always tell people who are not well or women who are not looking after themselves, I would say even if you have to put on just a lipstick and just tie your hair up, because I remember my mom, again, I'm coming back to my mother. When I was growing up, my mom told me something really important. She said, when you get married, make sure that you wake up in the morning and don't look disheveled in front of your husband, okay? Have a shower, just tie a ponytail, be clean, fresh face, but look well-dressed. Don't look like a rag, because no man wants to see a woman who looks like a rag, okay? And I think somewhere that stayed in me. So I always, even if I'm feeling very low, I always dress up and just to feel good, because when you feel good about yourself, you can make someone else feel good about themselves. And so that's what I tell the women at my work. Don't be ashamed to look good, dress up, feel good. You know, you don't have to be provocative, but you have to dress to feel good. And so I empower them by letting them know that my phone is on for them. And for anyone I interact with, I tell that to my friends too. My number is on 24/7. So all my friends out here, please know that you can depend on me any time of the day and night, all throughout the year.
Be a bit careful with that one. Okay. Malini, let me get you in and then I'll go to Shaheen.
So honestly, I've always said that I've actually had both sides of this experience. So when I started off my career, it kind of helped being a woman, you know, because there'd be a bunch of guys with big cameras and they'd be all sweaty, but I'd be like, excuse me, and like, please, and then, okay, she's a girl, let me go up front and take a picture. So it actually worked to my advantage. But I think over the years, I've realized there's a subtle kind of fear and annoyance, exactly like you're saying, like, I can't take it anymore, that you condition yourself. You're like, oh, if I'm going to an event, I'll make sure that I have to be a certain amount of standoffish and that I will have to walk away. If there's a drunk guy at the bar, I will have to move first. And I think there are little things that in the bigger picture, you know that there's so much worse happening to other women that it's almost like, okay, this is not as big a deal. But at the same time, it's ironic that we always, you know, we hear these stories and we're like, oh, it's the uneducated man who rapes women, or it's the uneducated man who's, you know, being violent. That's not true. There's so much violence and abuse and even, you know, mental torture that happens amongst people who are so well-educated. And I think that's the part that's really disturbing, you know? I mean, I think I was speaking somewhere recently and I was speaking on a panel and I know it was really about something that I felt strongly about entrepreneurship and storytelling. And at the end of that, you know, there was a man who was supposed to ask me questions and he asked me something really stupid, like, oh, how have you resisted the urge to have an affair with someone in Bollywood? And I was just looking at him, I was like, if I was a man, you would never have asked me this question. And two, it was kind of like you've kind of taken everything I've taken 15 years to build and made it so small. And like, how dare you do that? And it's like subtle things, because again, in comparison, it's like, oh, well, they didn't touch you, they didn't do that. But it made me feel so bad emotionally that I realized that there's a real depth to it. The other thing I realized, and just like Farah says, we have a responsibility to a lot of the women who work with us. So recently there was supposed to be a meeting, one of my girls is supposed to take a meeting in Delhi with a big politician about something, new project that's starting. I don't know who he is. I have no reason to believe that he's gonna misbehave, but the meeting could only happen at 8 p.m. But I was not comfortable asking her to go for this meeting, because what if, you know? And I feel like that's sad for her and for me and for him, who might be a wonderful guy who probably wouldn't do anything, or for her to not be able to get this business in where she works on a commission. So it has this domino effect. So I think that's part of the problem, is that we also have this responsibility for the girls. That, I mean, I have like 30 girls who work in my office. And you know, recently you hear all these stories, whether or not they're proven or not, about men misbehaving with women in the workplace and even in, you know, the digital companies. And I feel so grateful that I can trust that this is not going to happen in my company. There's so many women here. But it's, you know, we live in under this false pretense or belief that, oh, this doesn't happen to me, where it could be, you know? And just like you're saying, that we have to convince, we have to, you know, be take care of ourselves and be like, okay, I'll behave a certain way. I won't ask for it. You know, and the guys never have to think like that. You know, like a guy will never be next to a drunk woman at a bar and have to move away, you know?
I think as both of you are saying, every little bit counts, and it's important. It's important, you know, when we're thinking about empowering others. Yeah.
I just want to add quickly that to all the women out here, that I've realized that most men are really scared. So if you're very strong and you come across strong, men don't mess with women who look strong and who they think is going to rebut them, okay? So even if you're in a situation where you're shit scared, act strong, be strong. The man's going to run away really quick, trust me.
How many men are in the audience today? I want to see if they're shivering right now. All right, Shaheen, Shaheen's wondering what to add here.
I'm sitting here thinking I should have probably changed the jeans that I wore to work. I don't like to dress up and I still feel good. So I think there are all kinds of women out there. But I think, just again, I mean, it's been a little bit of a theme of what I've said, but I just feel incredibly lucky and blessed and have had some small instances in my life that have been difficult with men, with women also. And I think there are all kinds of people out there, but I have realized that like there's such a fear I have of us losing our ability to trust each other as human beings. And part of my work has been to say, how do we break that down when kids are really small? Because when you grow up with someone really different from you, whether it's a girl and a boy or a high-income kid and a low-income kid, you grow up as friends, everything in your world shifts and changes. And so I think a lot about that, about how deeply interconnected we are and about our common humanity. We see our differences so easily and we judge so quickly. But what does it take to really drive change in the world through gentleness and through love? And through giving people chances, knowing, as at least has been my biggest lesson, is just how flawed I am. Like every day I realize there's so much wrong with me. There's so much that needs to get better. And I think the more I realize that in myself, the more gentle I am with the world outside. So that's a little bit about what I'm thinking.
I want to add to what Shaheen is saying about, you know, there's so many people out there that we always need to help. And I had this thought the other day. I said, you know, we come from a country where you believe that if you had bad karma, you're born poor. And that's what you think. And I said that that's not true, actually. And I believe that God is actually testing the ones who have things. He's testing us to know if we're going to part with what we have and help the less empowered. And are we going to empower them? So the actual test is on us, not on the poor people. So we are being tested. So if you're fortunate, you have to think you are privileged and you're actually being given a chance to prove your karma for your next birth. So you better go out and help all those people out there, because those people are your test in life. And that's humanity. We have to love people and we have to empower those who don't have as much as what we have.
So let me take that forward for a moment and get a sense of how all of you feel, you know, society and all of us present here today could take steps, whether they be small or big, you know, and just in our everyday lives to make things better for other women and for young women out there. Krishika.
My company started with a forum, especially for the women, if they have gone through any initial problems or anything facing in my company, because there are a lot of people, a lot of women. My CEO is a woman, my PR head is a woman, my marketing team is a woman. So we formed this, any problem any woman is facing in my company, they can come to us and they can speak about their problems and we would go ahead and help them. And that's, I like what Farah said. It's very good to have a mentor. If you could help the real people, like I look for new directors always in my field, because I see their capabilities and I feel, okay, they are worth it. I do give them a chance. I've given many new directors chance in whatever film I'm producing and have 2-3 others coming. They've just hardly, you know, if you hear their stories, it's incredible how they make that short films and they come to you. It's good to recognize them and give them your helping hand and think they will rise quite above. Just they need that one little help, and that's what I've just started doing. And actually doing from past few years.
Which is something even many big business houses haven't implemented till date. So that's fantastic. Malini?
So honestly, I think that there's so many little things, just like you said, they don't have to be grand gestures always. And I think one thing, especially in my line of work, I've realized that there's so much internet bullying, and I'm sure everyone's faced it, whether Farah, you get trolled, or I get trolled, or somebody says something nasty, because they're sitting behind a computer screen and they can say whatever they want. And I think one of the most important things that we try to encourage is this, Girl Love campaign, which I think Superwoman has started, she's a big YouTuber, is that, you know, women actually are the cruelest to other women, and all of us have this experience growing up. There's been some girl who's just been really mean to you for no reason, and you've probably been that girl in somebody else's life, not even knowingly, you know? So I think it's very important, even today, to start to make that effort. You can do two things. One, if you feel like, you know, for whatever reason, you're going to say something unkind to someone, just don't say it at all. Don't put that negativity out in the world. And two, do the opposite. Find one girl in your life, whether it's somebody in your workplace or your mom or your sister or your friend or a total stranger. And I do this often, and I think I make people really uncomfortable. I'll be somewhere in a totally random place and I'll say, oh, I really like your shoes, your hair looks great, and look at me like, why are you talking to me? You know, but you have to do these little things, and it really makes a difference, because if you reach out to someone and you make them feel something good, and they're just really simple ways, and I think one of the most amazing things is how children handle it. And you see that, you know, just the way that they're so resilient and they have so much love and hope to give to each other. So I think it's very important that we do, especially as women, number one thing, don't tear other women down, because we're all in it together. And the more we support each other, the greater all of us will rise. And it doesn't mean that I need to pull someone down to get up in the water. There's more than enough room for everyone to be successful. And I promise you, as soon as all women started doing that with each other, nothing would hold us back.
They say it takes almost 7 compliments to heal 1 negative criticism. Shaheen, let me come to you.
I'm thinking about my favorite children's book. It's called The Giving Tree. A lot of you may be familiar with it. If you're not, highly recommend you pick it up. It's a small book. But it's about a tree and a little boy. And the little boy keeps taking from the tree, first the apples, then the branches, then eventually cuts the trunk down. And at all times, the tree keeps saying, I still love you. I still love you. And the boy keeps taking more, and the tree keeps loving the boy. And finally, the tree is just a stump. And the tree himself doesn't know what more there is to give. And the boy comes, and he wants more. And the tree looks at him and says, well, an old stump is good for sitting and resting. Come sit, boy, and be happy. And I think about the idea of giving, again, something I've learned from my kids. I resonate a lot with what Malini said, that like little things every single day for the people around us can really change the world. But I also think in today's world, with literally the world falling apart around us, we're charged to step up and do a lot. And to say, like, how can I do 10 times more than what I'm doing today, 100 times more than what I'm doing today, towards whatever I feel drawn to and I feel passionate to? And I think that's the message I've started thinking about a lot. Like, if it really were like my last few days in the world, like, what's the most and the maximum I can do to really understand what it means to give?
Right. Farah?
To me, to empower other women would be to, firstly, to change the mindset from childhood, to educate them, to teach them that women are equal to men, and we can actually be very progressive, because we still live in a country where you go to small towns and women have different mindsets. They believe that they have to do certain jobs for their homes, their families, which is fine, but they feel guilty if they don't do that. And we need to change the guilt attached to all the chores that they're supposed to do. It should be something you're doing because you're happy. And we have women who believe that they first need to serve their children, their mother-in-laws, their husbands, and last themselves. And the most important thing, if you fly in an aeroplane, they say, in case of cabin pressure, pull the mask to yourself first before assisting others. If we are not happy, we cannot make anyone else happy. So as women, we need to first look after ourselves before we look after our husbands, our children, our mother-in-laws, our mothers, I mean, everyone, our friends, our family, and that's important. So we need to teach women to be happy to look after themselves without being guilty. And I think that's the most important empowerment for women, to change the mindset.
the big challenge, I think, that we all face, women from all walks of life. I think we have time for just a couple of questions. So we're going to get a mic around. If anyone would like to ask any of our panelists or all of them, just raise your hand. We'll send a mic in. Just introduce yourself and also direct the question to whoever you'd like to hear from, if there is a specific panelist you want to hear from. Anybody? You're not going to get this chance again to have all these beautiful ladies captive tonight. So, and another lady at the back as well.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. I'm Dr. Tejasvi. I'm an occupational therapist. It's glad to come here. Yeah, I always notice that it's so difficult for someone to have a role reversal. As in, I see my parents, like the children that I rehabilitate, that mostly there would be mothers coming into the clinic, getting the, you know, doing all the possible adjustments. But I've not seen mostly, you know, the fathers getting their children and doing some adjustments. So I would just like to know if you have noticed any role reversals and father being as active as the mother. Yeah.
I think this is a really important question because this seems to be a theme that's recurring in every conversation lately, and that is that education needs to spread to some extent to the men as well. Do you see that happening? Who'd like to take that?
Yes, you're right. Very few men actually take on the job of changing the diapers and doing the things that Western men would do in India. We still have to change that mindset, but a lot of youngsters, I think the millennials, the young fathers today are actually doing that. Maybe not Generation X, but the millennial definitely. So I think there is a change and it's going to come slowly.
I do agree. Yeah. As I said, my support is my husband. He helps me when I'm traveling and I'm shooting around. He takes care of my kids very well. He checks with his homework and any few things, their needs or anything, he's my helping hand. I just don't have to worry when I'm working and I'm traveling, because without him, I don't think so I would be here.
I just have to add to her, because I was on my way here and my daughter Fiza, 12-year-old, she's gone and fractured her forearm. And I had to call my husband and he rushed her to the hospital to get her in a car. So yes, there are men who actually get involved.
I have to say the same thing. I don't know how to cook anything. Like I don't even know where anything in the kitchen is, to be honest. But my husband, he cooks. He always makes me feel like it's not like he's doing me a favor, you know. And it's just, I think there is a generational shift and I think it's happening to us. And I think the real shift will be evident where it's not like, oh my God, he did this. It should be like normal, everyday things. And I think that the best thing that we can do is, one, educate the next generation, and even positive reinforcement, you know? So if you have a friend or your brother is good to his girlfriend, you should be like, yeah, good job, bro, you know? So it's all about making that generational shift, which I think I'm happy to say that I see it. I see it in quite a few places.
And I think most of the successful women you meet have a positive story to tell in terms of an understanding and support at home. So hopefully we're going to see a lot more of that. I think there's a lady at the back.
Can I? Yeah. So my name is Sangeeta Wadhwani and I'm the executive editor of Hello Magazine. And have met Malini on a couple of occasions, still hoping we can catch up. I thought it was very interesting what you said about women being nurturing bosses. What Farah was saying, what Malini was saying, where you'd actually worry and have concerns about how happy the women in your employ would be. It's a tragedy, though, I think, in a lot of homes in India, the maids don't necessarily get that kind of nurturing. You know, we tend to take the home staff a lot more for granted. So I just wanted responses from the panel, whether you agree with me.
I can't live without my help, Cole Manali, okay? I think I look after her as well as I would look after my own family member. And it's not just because she assists me, but because I believe that it's our moral obligation as human beings to look after anyone who works for you. And I say that from the bottom of my heart, not because I want to sound like I'm being good. That's my way of life, to care, to be humanitarian, and to look after each and every member of your staff. And that's why I say, call me any time of the day, 24/7.
I think exactly what you said, it's very important to have, you know, for them to also have that support system. And I don't think it needs to only apply to the maids. It should apply to your watchman or your driver or anyone who, you know, who is part of your family in that sense, just like Farah said, you know, because maybe it's not possible to help every single person that you see in need. And that's why we become a bit desensitized when you look out the window and you can't help every kid who's knocking on the glass. But the ones that you can empower and can help in little ways. And sometimes it's not even about money, right? Sometimes it's even some things like helping them with clothes or shoes or some small piece of education or something that they can, you know, if they need, maybe sometimes it's money as well. But there are little things that you can do. And sometimes all they want is to be able to share their happiness with you. Like my maid's daughter, you know, just had a baby and she just wanted someone to be excited with her and not feel like she's completely disconnected from your world and not be invisible. So I think that also helps.
Just one more thing, because she was saying it's not just about money. In my organization, I actually gave my employees a chit and I said, fill in 5 things that make you happy and 5 things that make you unhappy. And I've actually got all of them down. And now this week and this month, I'm actually going to sit with 99 of them and going to counsel them through what they have, because I read through their needs and they're very simple needs. So a lot of it is to do with the mind. If you don't empower your team and their human resources, they really won't be able to give you their best. So it's very important to listen to their problems. And they could be very small or they could also be big. But you have to be available to be there to help, to at least seem like you want to help and you can help.
Yeah, exactly. I would add to that. I think charity begins at home. And my hairdresser, he has a son who's around 8 to 10 years old, and like he came up to me, he's saying, my son, he loves playing football. So I said, sure. So I put him in the place where my son used to go for football in the evenings. So I paid for him and this, and then I get a call from the master. He says, what a fantastic boy this is. He's incredible. He beats all the children over there. And he is so good the way he played. I was like, you know, I was so happy to hear that I put him in the right place. And he left from there. And now he started doing, he wants to act. He's a 10-year-old guy. He's gone and he's given auditions. And he's started going to the beach. And he's seen everybody doing those cartwheels and somersaults. He's gone there and he's learning on his own slowly. I'm like, you can see what, you know, I think if you help these kind of children, I think they'll reach somewhere.
All about creating the right opportunities. We have now many questions. So let's go across that lady there and then someone tell me how much time we have.
I'd like to take the panel to the first few questions. So I want to understand that you guys mentioned that we have passion that drives you, everyone. But what is that drives you day? You know, that teeny tiny bit of motivation. There are days that we all feel very low. On those days, how do you buck up and do what you do?
That's a difficult one.
That's actually a very easy one. When I'm low, I think of everyone I know all around me who have less than what I have, because I wake up every morning and before I open my eyes, the first thing I say, thank you, God, I'm sleeping in this AC room, I'm sleeping on a bed, I have a pillow, I have a cover. And these little things just pep me up, because when I travel, I'm not always on my phone, I'm actually looking around and I see lots of people on the streets and their children. And they're poor people, and they're handicapped. And I look at, I drive to the gym every morning, and sometimes I see someone who is handicapped and has no leg. And at that point, I just stop, and I say, thank you, God. I shouldn't be complaining about stupid things that I can fix. I should be more trying to fix things that other people have, you know. And so I don't feel bad. I mean, I instantly pep up when I think of someone. I think I'm not blind, I'm not handicapped, I'm not dying. Someone I love is not dying. These are the things you should think of if you're feeling low, and quit getting out of that mood and be positive and be charged.
I think for me, it also functions on a level of FOMO, the fear of missing out. So I think part of that, the thing I said about passion is if you really find something that you love doing, it's the cliche, but you really will never work a day in your life. So I love every day of my life. Some days I wish I could be in my pajamas on the sofa writing, but it doesn't mean I don't like what I do. Like those, if you find what you love, you will always enjoy every day.
All right, go for it.
How much important it is to be emotional alongside being passionate at work.
Is that the feedback you're getting at work?
It depends. I want to explain to me, how do they say it? Like, are they just like, are you crying over the numbers? Like, No. In what way are you being?
No, not that way. I'm very unlike a chartered accountant, so to say. But being a woman and being a mother recently to a one-year-old, I'm very emotional at workplace. Like, I relate to people very, very quickly. Or maybe those who are not so privileged, I get touched or affected sooner. Yeah. So I don't know. I mean, at times I get this feedback specifically from my male colleagues who say that I'm too emotional. Maybe with my client work, with my team.
You should just tell them they may not be emotional enough.
Yeah, but that's what I can't do.
Being emotional is good, actually. So, yeah, I mean, I'm an extremely emotional person, and I think that's what drives us. We're all emotional about our work, about our friends, about the people we love. And I think that's very good. And if you're getting emotional, it's great, because you're not keeping the stress inside you, you're letting the stress out.
Yes.
You know, so continue doing it. Don't do it too much.
Sure, thanks.
All right, I think we've run out of time. So you should all ask your questions faster. But no, we run out of time. And I just want to say thank you for being a fantastic audience, but a big round of applause to this wonderful panel here tonight. Ladies, you were absolutely fantastic. Thank you. So if you could just stay on stage for a moment, because before any of you run off, we're going to have some pictures. I think we have Karan here with us. Come, Karan.
Namansi began her career in theatre, moved on to modelling, and she's acted in more than 100 commercials. She's hosted shows on television and is an award-winning actress who has been part of several hit TV shows over the last two decades. She's recently returned to television after a hiatus with a new daily soap called Dhai Kilo Prem. Mansi is also an avid traveller and blogger. Mansi, we'd love to have you on stage.
Good evening, all of y'all. We came in a little late, but we got a lot of the conversation, and it was very stimulating, and I agree with a lot of what everyone was saying. I am a woman. I'm very happy to be here because Karan's a dear friend, first and foremost. He said that I want you to come here and talk to these two ladies, and the minute he told me who they were, I was like, of course I will be there. Without a doubt, it would be my honor to share the stage with them and to have a conversation with them. So without much further ado, let's begin with that. Gauri, Sawant, can we please have you on stage? A very big welcome.
Mummy naraaz to hone hi wali. Wo to chahti hai ki main doctor hi banu. इसने हॉलीडेज खत्म और बोर्डिंग स्कूल शुरू, एक दिन भी एक्स्ट्रा रुकने नहीं दिया। मम्मी भी ना। मम्मी ने अपनी लाइफ अपने आप ही बनाई। 18 साल की थी जब उनके फादर ने उन्हें घर से निकाल दिया। अकेले रहने का तो सोचने से भी डर लगता है। मैंने अपने पापा को कभी देखा नहीं और मेरी असली माँ वो बहुत बीमार रहती थी। उनके बारे में सिर्फ एक ही दिन याद है जो मैं कभी भुला नहीं पाती। एक दिन कुछ लोग आए और उन्हें एम्बुलेंस में ले गए। फिर वो कभी वापस ही नहीं आई। फिर एक दिन मम्मी आई। बहुत प्यार से मुझे अपनी गोद में बिठाया और मुझे अपने घर ले गई। तबीयत खराब थी तो पूरी रात मेरे साथ बैठी रही। सुबह मम्मी ने एक सुंदर सी रेड फ्रॉक पहनाई, मेरे लिए ढेर सारे चिप्स बनाए। मम्मी के साथ 10 साल हो गए, अब तो मम्मी मम्मी कम और दोस्त ज्यादा बन गई। संडे हम दोनों का फेवरेट दिन है। बालों में तेल लगाने के बाद दोपहर में मेरा फेवरेट लंच कड़ी चावल और रात में हॉरर फिल्म। डर लगता है पर मम्मी होती है ना तो नहीं लगता। ये है मेरी मम्मी, है ना प्यारी। मैंने लाइफ में इतने प्रॉब्लम्स देखे, कितना कुछ सहा है, पर फिर भी उन्होंने हमेशा मेरा ख्याल रखा है। सिविक्स बुक में तो लिखा है कि सबके लिए बेसिक राइट सेम होते हैं, फिर मम्मी को क्यों नहीं है? इसलिए मैं डॉक्टर नहीं लॉयर बनूंगी, मेरी मम्मी के लिए।
Gauri's video went viral. Within the first week, it had more than 12 million views. This movie, as this little ad film that we all watched, it tells you a little about Gauri. But today, I'm here to talk with her and find out a little more about her struggle, her achievements, and to ask her, how does it feel to be where she is today, because she is a woman of extraordinary courage. I'm sure you all agree. सबसे पहले तो
थैंक यू।
मैं अपने आप को प्रिविलेज समझती हूँ कि मैं आपके साथ बैठ के बात कर रही हूँ। तो हम शुरू करते हैं थोड़ी सी आपके बारे में। हमें ये बताइए कि आपका ये जो गायत्री को अडॉप्ट करने का जो हुआ सफ़र, वो कैसे हुआ, वो पहले बताइए हमें।
करण जी का मैं सबसे पहले धन्यवाद करूंगी कि यहाँ मुझे बुलाया, और हमारे मुख्यमंत्री जी की मोहतरमा यहाँ है। मैं ज़िंदगी में दूसरी बार उन्हें मिल रही, एक बार वर्षा के उनके एक बंगले पे मिली थी लक्ष्मी जी के साथ, और आज दूसरी बार मिल रही हूँ। खूब बड़ा बटला तुम्हारा बगुल मैनी। यू आस्क मी अबाउट गायत्री
जी।
Before coming to Gayatri, means I have to talk about her past. I run an organization for transgender, and the transgender sex worker people who comes to our center, and sometimes the female sex worker also used to come to a center. And that time Gayatri mother was pregnant when she used to come to a center, and the female sex workers and transgenders are very friendly when they're on the ground. Okay. Very non-veg jokes and all everything, so she used to share. एंड जब गायत्री की मम्मी आती थी मैंने उससे पूछा तू पेट से है तो उसने आंखों से बोला हाँ माँ मैं पेट से हूँ तो मैंने बोला फ्रिज में नींबू का अचार है ले लेना तू जाते हो तो उससे बोला ठीक है ये गायत्री पैदा होने के पहले उसका मेरा इंट्रोडक्शन रिश्ता शुरू हो गया नाड़ जुड़ गई दिन गुजर गए गायत्री की मम्मी HIV पॉजिटिव थी और मुझे ये बारे में पता नहीं था और गायत्री जब 5 साल की थी उसकी मम्मी गुजर गई और जब वो HIV पॉजिटिव थी जो सेक्स वर्कर के इसमें थे उसका बहुत कर्जा हो गया था कोई लोग उसके वॉशिंग मशीन TV सब लेके गए और आखिर में सिर्फ गायत्री बची थी जिसे वो सोनागाछी बेचना चाहते थे गायत्री 4.5 साल की थी गंदा सा मैला सा कपड़ा पहना था और मैंने मुझे ऐसे पता चला कि मुझे एक मेरी स्टाफ ने कहा कि तुम्हाला माहिती आहे का लकाय ती होती ना तिच्या मुलीला ते विकतात ऐसे चल किधर है वी वेंट ओवर देयर बहुत सारे लोग बैठे थे बिहारी लोग थे बहुत सारे लोग थे ऐसे क्या हुआ तो बोले नहीं आप जाओ आप इधर दादागिरी मत करो बोले दादागिरी नहीं क्या करे वो बताओ तो बोले इसके लड़की के माँ का कर्जा था और वो हमें चाहिए वापस ऐसे कि पर माँ ने कर्जा लिया था बेटी ने तो नहीं कर्जा लिया और इस तरीके से फिर बहुत सारा झगड़ा हुआ और उस वक्त मेरे को अर्धनारी नटेश्वर का जो सब रूप होते हैं और सब मतलब हम लोग बोलते हैं ना कि जहाँ मुझे सोफेस्टिकेट होना है वहाँ मैं सोफेस्टिकेटेड होती हूँ जहाँ मुझे लाउड होना है वहाँ मैं लाउड होती हूँ और उस वक्त मैंने अगला पिछला नहीं सोचा बच्ची का हाथ पकड़ लिया तब मैंने ये नहीं सोचा था कि मैं उसकी माँ बनूंगी और इस तरीके से वो मेरी ज़िंदगी में आई
वाह पर मैंने कहीं आपके एक इंटरव्यू में पढ़ा कि आपने बोला कि एक औरत का कंप्लीशन एक बच्चे के साथ होगा वो आपके दिल में कहीं था और आपने इसलिए सोचा था कि आपको अडॉप्ट करना है
बिल्कुल बायोलॉजिकल आई वाज बोर्न एज अ मेल डॉक्टर ने डिक्लेयर किया था कि लड़का है मैंने खुद को कभी लड़का नहीं माना बिकॉज जेंडर इज नॉट योर इट्स योर आई ऑलवेज थिंक आई एम अ गर्ल और एक गर्ल होने के बाद व्हेन आई स्टार्टेड ग्रोइंग मैं लड़की जैसा बिहेव करने लगी मेरे घर वालों को उससे तकलीफ होने लगी और गर्ल होने के बाद एक मैच्योरिटी आ गई रिलेशन में आ गई सब चीज़ें होती गई और एक उम्र के एक पड़ाव पे आने के बाद तुम्हें लगता है कि और आगे क्या और उसी वक्त गायत्री मेरी ज़िंदगी में आई तो आई एम थैंक्स मैं भगवान से बोलती यार तूने मुझे चीटिंग किया औरत तो बना दिया यूट्रस नहीं दिया पर फिर मैंने तेरे ऊपर चीटिंग कर दिया मैं आज एक बच्ची की वाह
अपने खुद
विदाउट यूट्रस
बिल्कुल मैं भी मानती हूँ कि एक बच्चे की अपने ज़िंदगी में आने से कुछ ज़िंदगी बदल जाती है क्योंकि मैं जब माँ बनी मेरे लिए मेरी ज़िंदगी पूरी बदल गई और आज मेरी बेटी मेरी ज़िंदगी का क्या बोलते हैं सबसे अहम हिस्सा है गौरी टेल अस आपकी ज़िंदगी के बारे में थोड़ा कुछ बताइए हम सबको मालूम है कि ये आप एक NGO भी चलाते हैं सखी का है
सखी चार चौगी
तो उस NGO के बारे में बताइए बिकॉज आई नो यू आर वर्किंग शी इज़ वर्किंग फॉर ट्रांसजेंडर्स इन आवर कंट्री इन मुंबई स्पेसिफिकली ऑफकोर्स एंड ऑफकोर्स इट्स अ मूवमेंट दैट विल यू नो रेजोनेट ऑल ओवर द कंट्री देन
व्हेन आई लेफ्ट माई हाउस आई वॉज 18 एंड आई स्टार्टेड वर्क विद NGOs हु दोज हु आर वर्किंग विद MSM अ गे मैन एंड आई रियलाइज नो आई एम नॉट अ गे आई एम अ वुमन बट सो कॉल्ड सोसाइटी वॉज नॉट रेडी टू एक्सेप्ट माई वुमन Because it was quite funny for them to accept me as a woman. अगर आप कबर्ड गोदरेज का कबर्ड है 6 फुट का और उसमें अगर रेफ्रिजरेटर की तरह सब सिस्टम कर दो वो कूलिंग भी देगा तो भी लोगों को डाइजेस्ट नहीं होगा कि फ्रिज कैसे बन सकता है लोगों का ढांचा होता है ज़िंदगी ना औरत ऐसी होनी चाहिए और मेरे अंदर की औरत बेखौफ थी बेखौफ थी तो लोगों को शायद पसंद नहीं थी और इस तरीके से चार चौकी हमने स्टार्टिंग करना शुरू काम करना शुरू किया मलाड़ मालवनी में 2000 से ज़्यादा ट्रांसजेंडर रहते हैं और जो HIV एड्स से ज़्यादातर प्रभावित है तो उस वक्त लगा कि मैं चार चौकी में काम करने से पहले आई यूज टू वर्क विद शेल्टर डॉन बॉस्को मैं स्ट्रीट चिल्ड्रन बच्चों के साथ काम करती थी जो ड्रग एडिक्ट बच्चे हैं उन्हें मैं रेस्क्यू करती थी और शेल्टर डॉन बॉस्को में लाती थी फिर वहाँ पे वो रिहैब के लिए जाते थे एक दिन फादर ने मुझे कहा कि आप हिजड़ा हो आप बच्चों को जिस तरीके से पकड़ते हमें गलत लगता है आप प्लीज़ कल से काम पर मत आइए मैंने कहा ठीक है पर मेरी 3 महीने की सैलरी तो दे दो ताकि मैं घर तो चली जाऊँ तो उन्होंने कहा आके ठीक है बाद में लेके जाना एंड दिस वॉज फर्स्ट एक्सपीरियंस फॉर सो कॉल्ड हेट्रोसेक्सुअल सोसाइटी मेरे लिए कोई मायने नहीं रखता था कि मेरे लिए मेरे बच्चे ड्रग एडिक्ट ना बने यही मेरे लिए था मदर वॉज देयर और फिर जब मैं सखी चार चौकी शुरू करने लगी औरतों के साथ भी काम करने लगी ये सारी चीज और 2014 में सुप्रीम कोर्ट में मैंने पिटीशन दायर किया. मुझे बहुत खेद होता है यहाँ पे बोलने के लिए, ये मंच यहाँ उसके लिए नहीं है, माफ़ कर दीजिए मुझे. सुप्रीम कोर्ट का पिटीशन करने के लिए जब मैं सर्वोच्च न्यायालय के पास मेरे अधिकारों के लिए जाती हूँ, पार्लियामेंट में बैठे वाले लोग क्या कर रहे हैं. 2014 में मैं सुप्रीम कोर्ट में मैंने पिटीशन किया कि वी वॉन्ट अवर राइट्स, और इसलिए आधार कार्ड में एज अ थर्ड जेंडर आया है.
Wow, that's great.
And I'm the petitioner for the transgender bill.
Wonderful, wonderful.
तो इस तरीके से काम होता है. हमारे HIV रिस्क, हाई रिस्क बिहेवियर के लोग हैं, तो उनके साथ चार चौकी काम करती है, एम्पावर करती है लोगों को कंप्यूटर, क्योंकि लोगों को अभी भीख मांगना छोड़ के हम अगरबत्ती कैंडल बनाना नहीं सिखा सकते, और लोगों को इसमें इजी मनी है तो दूसरा क्या करेंगे.
एक डिग्निटी से जीना सिखा रहे,
तुम्हारे लिए परिभाषा है. डिग्निटी का परिभाषा क्या है यार?
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल.
डिग्निटी की परिभाषा क्या है? मैं एक किस्सा कहना चाहूँगी. मेरी बच्ची को मैंने इस तरीके से पाला है क्योंकि मैं उसे कहती हूँ कि बेटा मैं तेरा पप्पा भी हूँ, तेरी मम्मी भी हूँ. तो ऐसे देखती है मुझे. तो उसने मुझे पूछा, और बहुत सोचने वाली बात, मेरी बच्ची ने मुझे पूछा, 11 साल की लड़की मुझे पूछती है, आई शूर्पणखानी फक्त रावणाकडे डिझायरच व्यक्त केलं होतं ना, मग त्यांनी तिचं नाक का कापलं? शूर्पणखाने लक्ष्मण को सिर्फ बोला की मुझे तुम पसंद हो, उसने उसका नाक क्यों काटा? और रावण ने लक्ष्मण का नाक नहीं काटा, सीता को क्यों उठा के लेके गए? आप समझने की कोशिश करें मेरी बेटी कितनी ब्रिलियंट होगी.
वेरी ट्रू.
हम औरतों के ऊपर बात करते हैं, शोषण हमारे समाज में पहले से होता है, औरतों को हमेशा, उसका एक ही सवाल मुझे झिंझोड़ के जाता है. औरत होने की परिभाषा बहुत हम अलग अलग करते हैं. मेरे लिए इतना आसान नहीं था ये कफन का कपड़ा ओढ़ के. मैं आज रात को कहीं स्टेशन पर सोऊंगी तो मुझे पता नहीं होगा मेरे साथ क्या होगा, क्योंकि यही कपड़ा औरत होने की इज्जत मुझे देता है, पर ये मेरे सुरक्षा का कवच भी है. बहुत सारे ट्रांसजेंडर स्ट्रीट पे आप देखते हैं, सिग्नल पे खड़े रहते हैं. आप लोग बोलते काम क्यों नहीं करते हो? अभी तक काम नहीं दिया. अभी तक वुमेन एंड चाइल्ड डिपार्टमेंट के साथ हमारा पिछले 4 सालों से बजट आ रहा है पिछले गवर्नमेंट का, अभी तक पंकजा मुंडे इज नॉट रेडी. परसों हमने जाके मंत्रालय में तमाशा किया, और कल जाके हमारा त्यांनी तारीख दिली ताई ट्रांसजेंडर बिलसाठी. सुप्रीम कोर्टाचं ऑर्डर असून सुद्धा आतापर्यंत आपल्याला काहीच करत नाही आहे. आपलं फर्स्ट स्टेट आहे महाराष्ट्र, जिधर वेलफेयर बोर्ड के बारे में, कल्याणकारी बोर्ड कर दो, लेट गिव एजुकेशन. अभी भी कोई भी कॉलेज में अगर आप देखो, एजुकेशन दो.
बिल्कुल.
एजुकेशन होगा तो लोग भीख नहीं मांगेंगे, लोग एम्पावर होंगे.
जी, सबसे पहला पड़ाव आई थिंक किसी को भी एम्पावर करने का मेरे हिसाब से एजुकेशन हो, चाहे वो औरत है, बच्चा है, ट्रांसजेंडर है, कोई भी. द सेक्स ऑफ दैट पर्सन डज नॉट मैटर. करेक्ट. आपका जब आपको जब ये एहसास हुआ कि मैं औरत हूँ उस, और आप जो फैमिली में बड़े थे, आई बिलीव आपका नाम गणेश था तभी, डैडी चाहते थे कि आप पुलिस में भर्ती हो, बराबर, पर फिर भी आपने तो उस वक्त आपने अपने परिवार को, आपके घर वालों को कैसे समझाया? हाउ डिड योर ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन आकर आपके रास्ते में, आपकी जर्नी में कौन था जिसने आपको साथ दिया? क्योंकि ये जर्नी अकेले करना आई एम श्योर बहुत ही कठिन होगी, एंड आपने करी है, पर कुछ तो होगा जो लोग आप जिन्होंने आपका सहारा दिया.
कुछ बोल नहीं सकती हूँ क्योंकि बहुत कम उम्र में मम्मी गुजर गई. डैडी को 10वीं तक पता नहीं था, मैं बोर्ड एग्जाम को जा रही थी, पिताजी ने पूछा कुठे चल रहा है, तो मतलब माझी 10वीं एग्जाम है. आप समझने की कोशिश करो, एक पुलिस वाला जब अपने बच्चे को पूछता है कहाँ जा रहा है, तो उनका मेरा क्या रिलेशन रहा होगा? ऐसे का मतलब ये नहीं कि कभी उन्होंने मुझसे प्यार नहीं किया. मुझे आज भी पता है मेरे पिताजी हॉल में सोते थे सोफा सेट के ऊपर, और मुझे बेडरूम में सुलाते थे ताकि मैं चौड़ा फैल के सो सकूँ. वो आदमी ने कभी कुछ दूसरी शादी नहीं की, सिर्फ मेरे लिए. और आज मैं बहुत लकी हूँ, यहाँ पे मेरी कज़न सिस्टर और मेरे अंकल आए हैं, मेरे पिताजी के बड़े भाई, फर्स्ट टाइम 22 सालों बाद वो आज यहाँ आए. उन्होंने देख के मुझे मिलने के लिए आया, एंड 10 मिनट पहले मेरी बहन मेरे सामने, कज़न सिस्टर कम एंड स्टैंड इन फ्रंट ऑफ मी एंड शी आस्क्ड मी, डू यू रिकॉग्नाइज मी? आप बताइए मुझ पर क्या हुआ होगा. सो आई वॉन्ट बिग क्लैप फॉर माई बिग फादर, माई सिस्टर.
गायत्री अभी क्या कर रही है? बोर्डिंग स्कूल में गई है.
बिल्कुल.
क्या
गायत्री को स्कूल में डालने का पीछे का मकसद? जब छोटी थी तब मैं सोशल वर्कर हूँ, तो कभी रात को देर रात को आना पड़ता, तो सिक्योरिटी का बहुत सवाल है. और मैं मालवनी जैसे स्लम में रहती हूँ जहाँ पे पब्लिक टॉयलेट्स में कभी कभी बाहर जाना पड़ता, और तब मुझे हमेशा डर लगता था कि यार ये कांच का बर्तन मेरे पास घर में, डर लगता. मैं रात को 2 बजे भी बिंदास आ सकती हूँ, पर जब बच्चे आने के बाद मुझे 7:30 बजे के पहले घर पे ही आना है, और कहीं जाना है तो मैं देखती थी इनके घर पे आकर बच्ची को रखो तो वहाँ कोई लड़का या कोई आदमी तो नहीं है। लड़की रात को सोएगी तो मैं उसको बताती ए ताई आसन है आशे पाई गुंजो, ऐसे मत सो। ये बहुत सारी चीज़ें गायत्री आने के बाद मेरी बदल गई, एक जिम्मेदारी बदल गई। तो गायत्री आने के बाद फिर जिस तरीके से मेरा पढ़ाने में उसका मेरा योगदान नहीं, मेरे गुरु है, मेरे चेले हैं जिन्होंने गायत्री को देखा। ट्रेन में कोई भीख मांगने वाला हिजड़ा भी कान के किसी ने पैसे नहीं दिए बताइए ला दो कान के दे दे मैं मेरे बच्ची को दे दूंगा। कभी किसी ने ड्रेस लाया गायत्री के लिए। और एक दिन सडनली क्या हुआ कि उसका स्कूल में किसी के साथ झगड़ा हुआ, उसने ताली बजाना चालू किया, शी स्टार्ट क्लैपिंग। एनवायरनमेंट ही ऐसा था, बाई आती हमारे पास सुबह खाना बना के चली जाती है और मेरे घर में सभी किन्नर है, DIC ऑफिस में पली बड़ी NGO के ऑफिस में। तो शी स्टार्टेड क्लैपिंग, प्रिंसिपल को पता था, टीचर ने हमको बुला लिया और कहा ठीक है पर ये लड़की तो इजड़ा नहीं है, ये आपके प्यार से बिगड़ गई है। अब वो डिसीजन मेरा था कि अभी इसे अलग रखना चाहिए। अब बहुत तकलीफ हुई है।
पर आई थिंक इस बात की दाद देनी चाहिए कि आपने आप उसे जो जिंदगी दे रहे हैं आई एम श्योर इट्स बेटर देन जो उसके नसीब में होती अगर कहीं आप उस वक्त नहीं पहुंच जाते। तो भगवान ने शायद आपको पहले से डिसाइड किया था कि आप उसकी माँ बनने वाले हो, इसीलिए वो आपका रिश्ता उसके साथ वो पहले से ही नींबू के अचार से शुरू हो गया। हमें ये भी बताइए कि आज आपके हिसाब से वॉट आर द चेंजेस, ऐसे छोटी छोटी क्या हमें परिवर्तन लाना चाहिए सोसाइटी में जिससे वी ट्रांसजेंडर्स के लिए एक जीना आसान हो जाए या एक जो राइट्स तो चाहिए सिविल राइट्स तो उसके लिए तो आप लड़ी रहे हैं, उसके अलावा आपके हिसाब से ये क्या चीज़ है जो हमें करनी चाहिए जिससे कुछ बदलाव आए।
मैंने फर्स्ट कहा कि एजुकेशन होना बहुत ज़रूरी है। अगर स्कूल और कॉलेज में अगर हमारे छोटे छोटे ट्रांसजेंडर्स होते जो घर छोड़ के भाग के आते अगर उन्हें स्कूल और कॉलेज में एडमिशन मिलेगा एज अ ट्रांसजेंडर तो वो पढ़ाई करेंगे। एक बार एजुकेशन आ जाएगा एम्प्लॉयमेंट ज़रूर आ जाएगा, पुलिस में या किसी में किसी भी नौकरी मिलेगी उन्हें, एम्पावरमेंट आ जाएगा उनके साथ तो वो काम करेंगे। सिग्नल पे दिखने नहीं के पीछे का सलूशन भी तुमको सोचना होगा। आज हम देखते हैं और मैं ट्रांसजेंडर के साथ अलावा मैं फीमेल सेक्स वर्कर के साथ काम करती हूँ। मैं किसी को बोल रही थी परसों मैं कमाटीपुरा में थी रेड लाइट एरिया में, 19 साल की नेपाली लड़की मुझे आके बोली क्या अम्मा टकाटक दिख रही है आजकल TV पे दिख रही है। तो मैं बोली जा 120 पान लेके आ, पान लेके आई वो और उसके साथ छोटा बच्चा था। मैं बोली क्या नाम है रे इसका, तो बोली करिश्मा नाम है। इतनी हमारी बात हो गई, बोली 2 मिनट रुक जा अम्मा मैं बैठ के आती हूँ। आप समझिए 19 साल की लड़की सेक्स वर्क करने के लिए जाती है, बच्ची को बाजू में लिटाती है, मैं वहाँ रुक नहीं सकी। मुझे उसका पान भी नहीं चाहिए था क्योंकि मैं मेरी नज़रें चुरा के वहाँ से भाग के आई थी कि वो आने के बाद उसका पान कैसे खाऊँ मैं। तो समाज में बहुत सारी चीज़ें अभी बदलना शुरू है। हमारा कर्जत के यहाँ पे हमारे गुरु ने मुझे छोटा सा घर दिया है, वहाँ पे हम लोग शेल्टर बनाना चाहते हैं बच्ची लोगों के लिए जो रेड लाइट एरियाज की बच्ची है। ट्रांसजेंडर्स के लिए अगर कहा कि एम्पावरमेंट बोर्ड होगा, कल्याणकारी बोर्ड होगा, जैसे बाकी के स्टेट में बोर्ड्स है, बाकी के स्टेट में सब जगह, छत्तीसगढ़ में है, कर्नाटका, केरला में एजुकेशन दे रहे, केरला में पुलिस भर्ती में लोग है, हमारे लिए पॉलिसीज आएंगी। इंदिरा गांधी आवास योजना है, आज तक किसी ट्रांसजेंडर को घर नहीं मिला। वाई वी आर स्टेइंग इन स्लम,
राइट?
मुझे महाड़ा का अगर घर मिलेगा छोटा सा, मेरा खुद का घर होगा तो मैं वहाँ पे रेंट भर के महीने का तुम्हारा EMS भर सकती हूँ। दे नेवर गिव अस राशन कार्ड, हमको मिलने के लिए तकलीफ है। बैंक आधार कार्ड हमारे पास नहीं है, बैंक अकाउंट हमारे पास खुलते नहीं है।
Correct.
तो एजुकेशन अगर होगा और तुम्हारा फ्रेंडली, तुम ये कहते कि सबका
पॉलिसीज भी फ्रेंडली अगर हो जाएगी तो शायद बहुत बड़ा फर्क पड़ेगा। बिल्कुल, तो उसके लिए तो आप जद्दोजहद कर रहे हैं एंड आई होप दैट, आई डोंट नो हाउ बट ऑल ऑफ अस एंड करण गुप्ता यू स्पेशली विद योर फाउंडेशन लेट्स डू समथिंग टू हेल्प एंड एम्पावर एंड बी द यू नो हेल्प गौरी with her cause because I think that's what we should do. Anybody would like to ask any questions to Gauri, please?
Gauri, aapki jo kahani sunkar bahut khushi hui and I'm very very honored to be here with you. Mera sawal ye hai ki hum jo hai hum kya kar sakte hain aap logon ki madad karne, I mean hum log kya kar sakte
hain? Jaise aap jogging ke liye jate hain koi hijda dikhega uska puche tera naam kya hai, वो बोलती चमेली, बोला चल मेरी गाड़ी में बैठ चाय पी के आते हैं। बस utna hi kijiye. We have enough money. We don't want to beg you. We need a respect.
Thank
Hamare
you.
Log kabhi tang nahi karenge. They are needy. Aap ye sochiye ki pyar ke bhooke hai. Hamare sath koi acha baat nahi karta. Women compartment mein hum jaate hain, aurte uthke chali jaati hain. Aap sochiye gents compartment mein main travel nahi kar sakti. Par hamare sath women ko to koi khatra nahi hai. प्यार से बोल दोगे तो भी बहुत कुछ होगा।
I think also एक awareness लाने की बहुत ज़रूरत है, लोगों को समझाने की ज़रूरत है कि क्या एक transgender person के लिए क्या what is the process, क्योंकि बहुत लोग मेरे हिसाब से ना समझते नहीं हैं कि what is the process which has made you into a transgender, why अपने country में ignorance बहुत ज़्यादा है इस बारे में मेरे हिसाब से।
See,
क्या आपको ऐसा लगता है?
नहीं,
सही है?
ऐसे बिल्कुल नहीं है। अगर हम मनुस्मृति का देखो, यक्ष गंधर्व दानव, इनका भी हम उपश्रेणी में आते हैं। बुध ग्रह जो है, जो नपुंसक ग्रह है, तो धर्म में कहा है विष्णु का अर्धनारी, विष्णु का मोहिनी रूप तुम्हें पसंद है, शंकर भगवान का अर्धनारी नटेश्वर तुम्हें पसंद है, तुम्हें वो पूजनीय है, पर हम पूजनीय नहीं है।
वही मैं बोल रही हूँ, आई थिंक शायद एक अवेयरनेस लानी चाहिए कि ये सारी चीजें जो है हमारी संस्कृति में बहुत सालों से लोगों को
बिल्कुल
इग्नोरेंस,
ये जो इग्नोरेंस हुआ ब्रिटिश लॉज जो आए तब से, कि जब ब्रिटिश आए तब इन्होंने लॉ लाया सेक्शन 377 के बारे में,
ब्रॉट बाय द ब्रिटिशर्स,
ब्रिटिशर्स, और तभी जाके हमारी हवेली, पहले राजाओं के रानियों के पास हम लोग थे, तभी इंटरनेट वगैरह नहीं था, तो रानियों का हेरम पूरा हम संभालते थे, खाना पकाना, जनान खाना सब हिचड़ों के पास हुआ करता था। हैदराबाद में हमारी हवेलियाँ हैं बड़ी बड़ी, पर आज हम सिग्नल पे है, स्ट्रीट पे है, बिकॉज क्यों, हमारा राजाश्रय चला गया है। पर हम ठीक है, आपसे भीख भी नहीं मांगते, हम हमारे हक मांग रहे हैं आपसे, वो भी आप नहीं दे रहे। हम भारत जैसे देश में जहाँ पे डॉक्टर बाबा साहेब अम्बेडकर ने कहा संविधान में लिखा आई द इंडियन सिटीजन, उसने तभी पुरुष और स्त्री भी नहीं कहा।
करेक्ट।
आज मैं न्यूज देख रही थी कि महाराष्ट्र के एक गांव में एक औरत ने दूसरा शादी किया, उसको टेंपल में जाने को बंद कर दिया। तो यहाँ पे मेरे बारे में कौन बात करेगा यार, ये विक्स का एडवर्टाइज आज आया, पर गायत्री मेरी जिंदगी में 12-13 साल
पहले से है। बिल्कुल,
आज मैं बच्चे लोगों की माँ हूँ, जब मैं बच्चियों के साथ पकड़ती हूँ, कभी उनका चॉकलेट चुरा के खाती हूँ, कभी उनको चिमटा भी निकाल लेती हूँ, माँ के सब रूप होते हैं।
बिल्कुल,
तो सोसाइटी को ये समझना बहुत जरूरी है कि जेंडर मदर डोंट लेबल मदर,
राइट,
इट कुड बी एनीवन।
एब्सोल्युटली, एब्सोल्युटली। एनी मोर क्वेश्चंस?
गुड इवनिंग मैम, दिस अभिलाषा हियर। मैम आई जस्ट थिंक के सोसाइटी एजुकेट होगी। मैं पर्सनली मेरी बात करूँ तो आई रियली रिस्पेक्ट थर्ड जेंडर, बिकॉज आई सी दे डोंट हैव ऑप्शंस, वो चाहें तो भी कुछ नहीं कर सकते हैं। कई बार ऐसा होता है कि वो काम करना चाहें तो भी सोसाइटी उनको एक्सेप्ट नहीं करती है। मैं सिर्फ ये कहना चाहती हूँ कि इज़ इट पॉसिबल कि ट्रांसजेंडर्स जो हैं उन्हें इतना एजुकेट किया जाए कि वो लोगों से भीख ना मांगना चाहें, वो लोगों से कोई गलत काम की एक्सपेक्टेशन ना रखें, वो सिर्फ ये एक्सपेक्टेशन रखें कि यू जस्ट गिव अस सम जॉब।
पता नहीं मैं तुम्हें क्या जवाब दूंगी, पर क्या सिग्नल पे सिर्फ किन्नर ही भीख मांगते?
नहीं मैम, वो बात नहीं है, बट एक अंडरलाइन स्टेटमेंट
से हमें पूछते हैं आप लोग भीख ही क्यों मांगते हो। एक औरत बच्चा लेके भी भीख मांगती है, अच्छे खासे आदमी
भी खड़ा रहकर मांगते हैं,
सब लोग भीख मांगते हो। बेगर एक्ट्स के तहत हम भीख नहीं मांग सकते क्योंकि वो गुनाह है, मैं उसका समर्थन नहीं करती हूँ। पर आप बोलो कि लोगों की मेंटालिटी, आप ये बोलिए, आज मैडम है यहाँ पे और ये मौका यहाँ पे नहीं है शायद बोलने का, पर मैं फिर भी रेज करूँगी क्यों। अभी आप देखिए, गवर्नमेंट ने हमारे लिए 5 करोड़ सैंक्शन किए वेलफेयर बोर्ड बनाने के लिए, दैट लेडीज नॉट गिविंग अस, व्हाई द हेल? आपकी सोच इतनी संकुचित कैसे हो सकती है? वेलफेयर बोर्ड बन जाएगा, हमें बहुत सारी चीज़ें मिलेगी। आज भी डॉक्टर हमें हाथ लगाने के लिए, क्योंकि डॉक्टर के WHO के गाइडलाइन के करिकुलम में अगर मेरा यूरिन ब्लॉक हो जाएगा तो कौन सा कैथेटर डालना है डॉक्टर को पता नहीं है। दिस इज नॉट लीगल सर्जरी व्हाट वी आर डूइंग, पीपल गो टू क्वैक डॉक्टर, डॉक्टर डोंट टच अस। फीमेल डॉक्टर के पास जाओ बोलेगा, जेंट्स के पास जाओ, जेंट्स के पास जाओगे तो बोले मुझे पता नहीं आपको कौन सा कैथेटर डालना है। ये बेसिक सुविधा है। भीख मांगने से तुम्हें क्या तकलीफ है? तुम्हें 1-2 रुपये दे के हट भी जाती हो। सुबह 7 बजे जब मैं सिग्नल पे खड़ी रहती हूँ, 12 बजे जब मेरे सर पे धूप आ जाती है, मेरे पैर में बाटा की चप्पल होती है, आप लोगों की बड़ी बड़ी गाड़ियों का बड़ा सा पोल्यूशन होता है, कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड मेरे ऊपर ज़्यादा छूटता है, तब आप नहीं सोचते हो?
मैम भीख मांगने से तकलीफ नहीं है, बस मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि आप लोगों को भी रिस्पेक्टफुल लाइफ मिलनी चाहिए.
बिल्कुल, और हम कोई भीख नहीं मांग रहे रिस्पेक्ट के लिए. हम नहीं देंगे तो छीन के लेंगे. अगर ये नहीं देंगे तो कल हम मंत्रालय में हमारी मीटिंग है विद पंकजा मुंडे, नहीं होगा तो आंदोलन होगा. पर एक औरत ही अगर दूसरे औरत को नहीं समझे, मुख्यमंत्री जी बहुत अच्छे हैं, जो मैं बटरिंग नहीं कर रही हूँ मैडम, नहीं तो आपको लगेगा मैं बटरिंग कर रही हूँ, क्योंकि रात को 2 बजे मैं वर्षा में जाके आई हूँ, मैं फोटो भी दिखा सकती हूँ मैडम नोज. तो पुरुष है ना वो बहुत है, पर औरतों को पता नहीं. शिविर सर हाँ चांगली साड़ी घातली है तुम्ही, अहो पण आमचे प्रश्न काय ते तरी बघा.
थैंक यू मैम,
थैंक्स,
ऑल द बेस्ट टू यू गौरी. वी होप के आपकी ये जो मीटिंग है वो सक्सेसफुल हो, एंड मोर पावर टू यू. एनीबडी एल्स?
माय गॉड, डोंट मेक मी स्केयर्ड.
मैडम तुमच्याकडे अगाध नॉलेज आहे, हे नॉलेज कसं तुम्ही डिराइव केलं? कारण महाभारत सगळंच तुमच्याकडे नॉलेज आहे. हाऊ डू यू डिराइव दिस नॉलेज?
सी आता ते ऐकून, आता म्हणजे मी बॉर्न ट्रान्सजेंडर नाही आहे, पण जेव्हा मी ट्रान्सजेंडर झाली, जेव्हा मी झालं की मला माझी संस्कृती पण कळली पाहिजे. जसं आपण म्हणतो की मी 96 कोळी मराठा आहे, तर मराठा ह्याचा अर्थ काय हे मला माझ्या आईवडिलांनी समजून सांगितलं की आपल्या 7 पिढीमध्ये कोणी असं नाही झालं. सुरेश वामनराव सावंत, वामनराव गोविंदराव सावंत ह्या जशा पिढ्या पिढ्यांचं गेलं तसं ट्रान्सजेंडरचा पण इतिहास आहे. मग गरुड पुराणामध्ये लिहिलेलं आहे, मनुस्मृतीमध्ये लिहिलेलं आहे, मग बुधग्रह ब्रह्मा काय आहेत ह्या सगळ्या गोष्टींचा अभ्यास केला. मी तुम्हाला सांगू, आम्ही जेव्हा किन्नर आखाडा सुरू केला तेव्हा आम्ही शंकराचार्यांना भेटायला गेलो. आत्तापर्यंत 4 शंकराचार्य आहेत, एकही बाई नाही आहे. का बायका संन्यास घेत नाहीत? मला शंकराचार्यांनी विचारलं तुम्ही कोण आहात, तर मी म्हटलं मी सावंत आहे. ते म्हणाले म्हणजे क्षत्रिय ना तुम्ही, तर तुम्ही नाही आचार्य होऊ शकत, त्याच्यासाठी फक्त ब्राह्मणच पाहिजे. पितृवाद पुन्हा आला इकडे, तर त्यांनी सांगितलं की नाही ब्राह्मण पाहिजे. मग मी पुन्हा प्रश्न विचारला बाई का नाही, तर त्यांनी मला उत्तर काय दिलं, अहिल्याबाई होळकरनीसुद्धा गादीवर बसल्याने त्यांनी शंकराची पिंडी ठेवली. पण शिखंडी हा ट्रान्सजेंडर होता आणि तो एका राजाचा राजा होता, म्हणून तो महाभारतामध्ये गेला. आणि गंगापुत्र भीष्मशी जे भांडण झालं, एन्टायर महाभारत जर तुम्ही बघितलं एका ट्रान्सजेंडरमुळे बदललं, कुठेच नाव नाही हो आमचं. महाभारत कोणामुळे बदललं? शिखंडी जर नसता थांबला तर गंगापुष्ठ भीष्म सगळ्यांना मारलं असतं. पण उल्लेख आहे का अंबालिकाचा? नाही आहे. तुम्ही हातामध्ये पाचू घालता बुधग्रह शांत करायला की हे असावं, फायनान्सचा कारक आहे. पण आमची फायनान्स कंडिशन खूप दयनीय आहे. आज माझं बँकेत अकाउंट नाही आहे, माझ्याकडे आधार कार्ड नाही, कारण की मी ज्या झोपडपट्टीत राहते माझं स्वतःचं घर नाही आहे. भरपूर साऱ्या गोष्टी आहेत. आणि अभ्यास म्हणाल तर त्याची सवय आहे की पुस्तकं वाचायची भरपूर, आणि मी स्वतः शिकलेली आहे. आणि माझ्यावर जे संस्कार झालेत, मी खूप लकी की माझी आई माझ्यावर कमी वेळ होती पण तिने माझ्यावर खूप चांगले संस्कार केलेत, आणि जे शिकवलं ते खूप चांगलं शिकवलं.
मला बस दिसते आता. Thank you so much. I think there are 2-3 more people who want to say something. Perhaps they would like to talk with Gauri a little later. Thank you so much, Gauri.
I'd like to extend a very warm welcome to our chief guest this evening. And, you know, a wonderful and most inspirational lady. We're most delighted to welcome Amruta Fadnavis. A social activist, a trained classical singer, banker, and also the youngest first lady of Maharashtra. Currently the deputy VP and corporate head of Axis Bank, Mrs. Fadnavis grew up in a household where education and independence for women were essential. She's currently working actively for women empowerment and development of rural India and has adopted 2 villages, Fethri and Kaudas, to improve village sanitation and infrastructure development. She has partnered with the BMC to promote wellness of the sweeper community and with Film City for welfare programs as well for their workers. She's walked the ramp as a showstopper for the promotion of Indian handloom and also the education of the girl child at New York Fashion Week. So as you can see, you know, her accolades are endless and of course cover a variety of spectrum. It's our pleasure to welcome her today at the I Am Woman event. Before that, we're going to just play a quick video.
Thank you.
Right. I'd like to invite on stage Dr. Kamal Gupta and Karan Gupta to give out the Karan Gupta Education Foundation I Am Woman of Substance Award to Mrs. Fadnavis this evening.
A very good evening to all of you, Mr. Karan Gupta, Mr. Kamal Gupta, and other dignitaries present here. In fact, I thought this would also be a question-answer session, but I can always give my peace of mind anytime when asked. Indeed, we all know that our society is full of problems, issues, concerns. And when we see the enormity of these issues, we sometimes feel where to start, how to go about it, because the issues are grave and we are just small. We are small to handle these issues. But here we should get reminded by the quote, by the inspiring quote of Mother Teresa. She said that I cannot change the world, but I can cast a stone across the waters and create many ripples. So this is about creating ripples, creating inspirations. And this is what the award also is all about. It is about recognizing women, recognizing their contribution, and inspiring others too to do the same. For me, charity always, I feel, begins at home. So to start my activities, start my contribution towards social causes, I chose Vidarbha. We all know that in Maharashtra, there is always perennial ongoing drought. 25,000 villages in Maharashtra had been declared drought affected, wherein since last 2 years, thanks to the government's Jal Yug Shivar Yojana, 11,000 are now out of it, but still 14,000 to go. And that made me choose Kaudas and Fetri, the villages which were badly affected by drought conditions. In Kavdas, in fact, people didn't even have water across miles to drink. They used to go miles and miles just to get a bucket of water. So we started with various programs in these villages, sanitation, digitalization of tribal and government schools, and so many other activities from skilling to improving the overall living conditions of the villagers. We started developing or digging borewells, wherein a government is not allowed to dig more than 200 inches. And with these kind of drought-affected villages, we don't find water at these levels. So we got special permissions to dig further and bring in water to these villages. So there were too many, many things to do, and the work is endless. But we have to realize that to traverse 1,000 miles, we have to take a first step. That is what we did, and we are still doing. What is needed the most in these villages is counseling. The farmers who are committing suicides, the children who have become suicide prone, they need these women who are getting awarded today here. They need to go there, tell their stories, and inspire these villages. And if you have time, you can always join hands and be a part of creating a revolution for our Annadatas. The second area of concern for me, I've always been touched by atrocities towards women. And that made me work towards causes like acid attack victims or taking care of the overall wellness of the labor class and all such things where women are involved. Now we are creating a network of women wherein police machinery would work parallel, but there would be empowered women who will take charge of atrocities which are committed towards women and take care that these are not done. And this network is going to go into villages, talukas, towns, everywhere. There is a lot to do, and in fact, what we do is just a drop in the ocean. But these drops matter, and the ocean is made of these drops. So let us keep on contributing, because we all want to be happy, and the best way to be happy is to lose ourselves to the service of others. So with this, I just call upon all of you. You all are people from privileged backgrounds, and I feel that destiny does not depend on the steps, shoes we wear, but on the steps we take. So let's take all positive steps towards the betterment of the society, so that one day we all stand up and say that yes, we live in an India of our dreams, an India which is free of all kind of negativities. So let's look forward to an empowered India with women folk making India a better place to live in. Thank you. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.
Ma'am, before you leave, we have a big request. Would you be able to sing a few lines for us today? Big hand, guys. Come on. Everyone wants her to sing, right?
Okay, this is a song. This is a private song which we made for motivating the acid attack victims. We had a program for them. Many celebrities joined hands to walk with them, and we had a comprehensive program where the 16 identified victims of Maharashtra got jobs. They got rehabilitated. The children, there were two children who were also attacked. They got sponsored for their education. So for them, we made a song to inspire them, to motivate them not to be bogged down for the deeds which were done by some bad people. So I'll sing this song, and it's a song of hope for all of us also.
हाँ, मुझे खुद पर यकीन है, ये कुछ ऐसा जुनून है, सारा समा मेरा और ये जमी ये आसमा अलग मेरा ये रंग है मेरी खुद से ही जंग है जीत जाऊँ ऐ खुदा अगर तू मेरे संग है
Thank you.
We are finally towards the end of the program. I've just come here to say that now we have a last guest and then of course the award ceremony. Laxmi Agarwal, who I quoted in my speech earlier today, is here now with us. We're going to show you a short video. Mansi is going to talk more about that. I think I just want to say that I was really stressed when Laxmi missed her flight today. And that's why she's late. And when she called me and said that my flight's delayed and I started panicking, she said, Gupta ji, pareshan mat hoiye, main aa jaungi. Ab kyun pareshan ho rahe, main aaungi. And I was like, all is well. All is well. So Laxmi ji is here. And Mansi, please come and we'd love to hear from both of y'all.
বাহ আপনার চুলগুলো তো অনেক সুন্দর কি করবেন ম্যাম
ছোট করব
এত সুন্দর চুল ট্রিম করে দেই ঠিক আছে ম্যাম
আরো ছোট করে দিন
আরো ছোট এবার ঠিক আছে মনে হয়
আরো ছোট করুন
একদমই চুলে যত্ন নেওয়ার সময় পান না না আপনার চুলে কিন্তু লেয়ার কাটটা খুব সুন্দর লাগতো এবার ঠিক আছে ম্যাম
আরো ছোট করে দিন যাতে এভাবে আর ধরা না যায়
Laxmi Agarwal is an Indian campaigner with Stop Acid Attacks and a TV host. She is an acid attack survivor and speaks for the right of acid attack victims. She was attacked in 2005 at the age of 15 by a 32-year-old man whose advances she had rejected. She has also advocated against acid attacks through gathering 27,000 signatures for a petition to curb acid sales and taking that cause to the Indian Supreme Court. Her petition led the Supreme Court to order the central and state governments to regulate the sale of acid and the parliament to make prosecutions of acid attack easier to pursue. She is the director of Chhaon Foundation, NGO dedicated to help the survivors of acid attacks in India. Laxmi received a 2014 International Women of Courage Award by the US First Lady Michelle Obama. Laxmi, we are very fortunate to have you in our midst today. Please welcome.
मैं ठीक लग रही हूँ सच में ना 22 अप्रैल 2005 में मेरे ऊपर एसिड अटैक किया और उसके बाद से मेरी लाइफ बिल्कुल चेंज हो गई बहुत स्ट्रगल रहा लाइफ में उसके बाद जब मैं आलोक जी से मिली तो आलोक जी को बताया कि ये प्रॉब्लम चल रही है तो उन्होंने बोला कि ठीक है हम तुरंत में तुम्हें कैंपेन में जॉब देते हैं फिर आलोक जी से मेरा एक अलग अट्रैक्शन हो गया और फिर दोनों को ही फिर इनको भी मुझसे प्यार हो गया और मुझे भी इनसे प्यार हो गया
हमने कमिटमेंट नहीं किया कि हम जिंदगी भर साथ में रहेंगे हमने कमिटमेंट किया कि हम एक दूसरे के साथ रहेंगे और एक दूसरे को जानेंगे
तो हमारी रिलेशनशिप बहुत नॉर्मल है, मतलब हमने एक दूसरे को पसंद किया है, प्यार किया है और वैसे रहते हैं।
शुरुआत में मैंने आलोक जी से ये बात शेयर की थी कि मुझे दुख होता है कि कभी पीहू बाहर निकलेगी, कहीं स्कूल जाएगी, कुछ ऐसा होगा तो पीहू इस बारे में कुछ, मतलब मेरे बारे में कुछ वो ना करे कि मुझे मेरे फ्रेंड्स ऐसे बोलते हैं, मुझे अजीब सा लगता है, मुझे ले जाने में अजीब सा लगता है। तो आलोक जी ने मुझे एक ही बात बोली थी कि तुम इतना कुछ कर रही हो तो वो शायद तुम्हें ये नहीं है कि वो तुम्हें देख के बुरा महसूस करेगी, उसको और गर्व महसूस होगा कि ये मेरी माँ है।
पर शायद पीहू के साथ अच्छी बात होगी कि वो शुरुआत से ही उन सब लोगों से मिल रही है, उसे उनके उनके पेन पता है, उनकी उसकी माँ को देख सर्वाइवर है, तो शायद वो इसी के लिए नहीं, वो किसी भी तरह की डिसेबिलिटी के लिए, किसी भी तरह की एबनॉर्मलिटी के लिए शायद तैयार होगी। और पीहू के आने के बाद यही हुआ है कि मतलब घर आने के रीज़न मिल गए अच्छे से, मतलब हम लोग काम में बहुत व्यस्त रहते हैं, हमारे फैमिली में जो नेगेटिविटी थी शायद उसको फील किया, उस जगह उसको हटा करके पीहू आई है।
हम लोग जितना टाइम होता है उतना टाइम स्पेंड करते हैं तीनों एक साथ, इंजॉय करते हैं, तीनों सच में चॉकलेट के लिए लड़ते भी हैं तो अच्छा लगता है तीनों।
आपकी ये स्टोरी सुन के इतना अच्छा लगता है, और इट्स सच एन इंस्पायरिंग स्टोरी, बिकॉज वॉट यू हैव डन इज़ दैट यू हैव सरमाउंटेड वॉट कैन बी कॉल्ड डिफ़िकल्टीज ऑफ अनदर लेवल, विच ना आम आदमी की ज़िंदगी में ऐसी डिफ़िकल्टी नहीं आती है, तो ये स्ट्रेंथ कहाँ से आई?
फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल थैंक यू सो मच कि आज मैं आप लोगों के बीच में हूँ, और करण सर बहुत अच्छा लग रहा है, बहुत खुशी हो रही है, फाइनली मैं आ गई यहाँ पे और मुझे लग रहा था कि मैं आ पाऊँगी, क्योंकि अगर आप जितने पॉजिटिव रहते हो, जितना पॉजिटिव सोचते हो, उतना पॉजिटिव आपको मिलता है। और क्योंकि मेरे ऊपर 2005 में एसिड अटैक हुआ था, और उस वक्त में मैं 15 इयर्स की थी, और जब भी कुछ भी होता है, चाहे हम बीमार होते हैं या कोई अटैक होता है, तो उस वक्त में हमें सबसे ज़्यादा अपनों की ज़रूरत होती है। और ये तो एक अटैक हुआ है, लेकिन अगर अचानक कोई बीमार हो जाता है और अगर हम उसे अकेला उस पेशेंट को छोड़ दें तो वो जीने की इच्छा ही छोड़ देगा, और अगर हम उसको सपोर्ट करें तो कभी, जैसे डॉक्टर्स भी कहते हैं कि इसको दवाइयों से ज़्यादा दुआओं की ज़रूरत है, तो उस वक्त में मेरे पेरेंट्स का मेरे साथ बहुत सपोर्ट रहा। मेरे रिलेटिव्स ने मेरा साथ छोड़ दिया था, मेरे दोस्तों ने साथ छोड़ दिया था मेरे आगे पीछे, और मेरे पेरेंट्स थे और एक आंटी थी पापा की बॉस, और लोग पूरी दुनिया के बराबर थे उस वक्त में। बहुत हिम्मत दी, उस वक्त मेरे साथ ऐसा हो गया कि मैं देर महसूस करने लगी, चलने लगी घुटनों के बल, बट लेकिन उसके बाद धीरे धीरे करके अंदर 2007 में मैंने 10th में एडमिशन लिया, फिर बैक टू बैक सिर्फ दिख हुआ है, लेकिन जो आप नॉर्मल लाइफ भी रेगुलर जो लाइफ जी रहे हैं उसके बाद भी लाइफ करनी पड़ती है। उसने एसिड डाला एक बार, लेकिन सोसाइटी एसिड डालती है हर दिन, हर दिन आपको बहुत सारी चीज़ पड़ता है, क्योंकि सोसाइटी ने मुझे निकाल के फेंक दिया अपनी अपनी जगह से। और उस टाइम कर लिया जब मेरे ऊपर अटैक हुआ, तो उस लड़के, वो लड़का जब एक महीने के बाद जेल से बाहर आया, उसने शादी कर लिया, और जब उसकी शादी हुई तो वही दिखता रही है कि मुझे रिजेक्ट कर दिया, बल्कि मैंने कुछ भी नहीं किया था, और उसके बाद कर लिया, और उसकी अरेंज मैरिज हुई। तब 2009 में मैंने ग्रेजुएशन बेसिक कंप्यूटर अपने बलबूते किया, बहुत हिम्मत करके, क्योंकि पेरेंट्स का बहुत सपोर्ट रहा। क्या चैलेंज था मेरे लिए? मेरे फेस को ओपन करके चलना। मैं फेस कवर करके डिसीज़न लिया कि मुझे फेस ओपन करके चलना है, तो उसके बावजूद भी लोगों ने कमेंट किए कि पीछे से बहुत अच्छी दिखती है, सामने से बहुत डरावनी दिखती है, लोग बच्चे देख के डर जाएंगे मुझे, लेकिन मुझे ऐसा फील हुआ कि लक्ष्मी, लोग तो नॉर्मल लोगों को भी नहीं छोड़ते हैं, जितने उन्हीं के लिए ही बुराई करते हैं। और वैसे भी क्राइम मैंने नहीं किया है, आईटी में से निकल के एक बंदा आता है और मेरे ऊपर एसिड डालता है, और मैं अपना फेस कवर करके क्यों कवर करना चाहिए सोसाइटी को? सम आपकी ही सोसाइटी में से एक बेटी के ऊपर एसिड अटैक हुआ है और वो अपना फेस कवर करके चले, तो उस सोसाइटी की बहुत थैंकफुल हूँ कि वो मुझे इतना नेगेटिव करते चले गए। बट लेकिन उसका अब लड़के ने ये सोचा था एसिड डालते वक्त, उसने मुझे जान से नहीं मारा, उसने मेरे ऊपर मेरी खूबसूरती इसलिए क्योंकि उसको लगता है कि चेहरा सबसे ज़्यादा ज़रूरी है। उसने सोचा कि मैं चार दीवारी में हमेशा नहीं अपनाएगा, उसने ये सोचा, लेकिन मैं उससे अपोजिट निकल गई। तो मुझे ऐसा लगता है उसके लिए सब, और कहीं ना कहीं आप सब लोगों से मुझे इतनी हिम्मत मिलती है कि मैं जब भी कहीं जाती हूँ साथ लेके जाऊँगी।
वाह वाह, आपकी मैंने एक टेडएक्स टॉक सुनी जिसमें आपने कहा कि ही थ्रू ऑल माई ड्रीम्स।
एग्जैक्टली।
तो डिड यू एवर मीट हिम अगेन? के बाद आपने कभी उसको सामना किया, आपको कुछ लगा कि मैं उसे जाके कुछ बोल?
क्योंकि जब शुरुआत में कोई अटैक होता है, क्योंकि एसिड अटैक बहुत हीनियस क्राइम, इतना पेनफुल है कि जब एसिड डलता है हम प्लास्टिक की पॉल मेल्ट करती है, ऐसी स्किन मेल्ट करती है और बहुत पेनफुल होता है, उनके लिए ट्रीटमेंट होता है। उस वक्त में ये फील होता है कि उसने मेरे साथ ऐसा किया, मैं भी उसके, लेकिन आप हमारे हाथ में एसिड दे दो, हम उसके ऊपर नहीं ऐसा कर सकते हैं। क्योंकि उसने, बहुत सारे लोगों ने कहा कि जिसने जैसा किया उसको वैसे ही करो, तो मुझे ऐसा लगा अगर हम भी उसके ऊपर एसिड डाल देंगे उसमें और हमें क्या फ़र्क रह जाएगा, तो हम भी क्रिमिनल। वही चीज़ मैं बहुत बार उसको फेस किया, उसकी वाइफ को फेस किया, उसकी फैमिली को फेस किया जो इतना सपोर्ट मुझे करती थी। मुझे ऐसा लगता था जब मैं कोर्ट में जाती थी कि क्रिमिनल मैं हूँ,
क्योंकि उसकी बहनें आपकी दोस्त थी,
तो यही लगता था कि मैंने, उसकी वाइफ मुझे ऐसे देखती थी और वो दोनों ऐसे आते थे कि जैसे किसी, और आके एकदम ऐसे खड़े हैं रुआब में और मेरे ऊपर ऐसा रिएक्शन दे रहे हैं मुझे कि मैंने वो, तो मुझे बड़ा वैसा फील होता था कि एक तो आपने रियलाइज़ नहीं किया। हाँ, मेरे मन में सवाल ये कि मैं उसे पूछना चाहती हूँ कि मैंने सिर्फ मना ही तो किया था शादी के लिए, के बावजूद आप था तो आपने कैसे शादी कर ली एक महीने के बाद ही, क्या रीज़न है? मुझे भी पता है क्या हो सकता है, उसने एक लड़की को यूज़ किया सिर्फ इसलिए जाऊँ जेल से, लड़की का ये यूज़ था, बट उस लड़की को शायद ही पता हो। मुझे लोग बेचारी बोलते थे बट मुझे लगता है वो बेचारी है और वो बेचारा है।
आपकी ज़िंदगी में आलोक जी कैसे आए?
मेरी, क्योंकि मेरे ऊपर अटैक हुआ उसके बाद धीरे धीरे करके मेरे घर की सिचुएशन ने लगे, क्योंकि कोई भी अटैक होता है तो वो सिर्फ एक पर्सन पे नहीं होता है, उसकी पूरी फैमिली। और मेरे पापा की 2012 में डेथ हो गई हार्ट अटैक से, क्योंकि मेरा, और डॉक्टर्स ने कहा कि वो नहीं बचेगा तो उनकी डेथ हो गई। फिर उसके बाद था, फील हो रहा था कि हमारे घर में एक ही अर्निंग मेंबर है और कैसे घर चलेगा, तो मैं काफ़ी जगह मुझे जॉब नहीं दे रहा था, तो मैंने जब कॉल सेंटर में भी बात की तो उन्होंने कहा कि लोग आपका कॉल पे, कौन कस्टमर देख के डरता है भाई, लोग तो चेहरा देख के डरेंगे तो मेरी कौन सी रीति लोग डरेंगे। उसके बावजूद भी मुझे जॉब नहीं मिली, मैं बहुत परेशान रही मम्मी भाई को। फिर 2013 में आलोक जी ने स्टॉप एसिड अटैक करके कैंपेन स्टार्ट किया था। 6 में मैंने एक PIL डाला था सुप्रीम कोर्ट में कि एसिड को बैन किया जाए, ऐसे खुलेआम एसिड ना बिके। अंडा बैन हो सकता है जो एक खाने की चीज़ है, तो एक एसिड क्यों नहीं बैन हो सकता जो एक इंसान की। तो उस वक्त में यही ख्याल आया और उसके बाद फिर इसका रिज़ल्ट 2013 में ही आया। बहुत है कि लक्ष्मी कौन है जिसने सुप्रीम कोर्ट में PIL डाला है और उसके बाद वो कहाँ है, वो कभी बाहर नहीं आती है, मीडिया से बात नहीं करती है, लेकिन उसके बाद एक लकली एक थी और उन्होंने मुझे ढूंढ भी निकाला, और वो लकली आलोक की दोस्त थी वो, और उन्होंने मुझे कैंपेन कर रहे हैं। उन्होंने 8 मार्च 2013 में ये कैंपेन स्टार्ट किया था। जब मैं उनके अलावा ऑलरेडी मैं 5 सर्वाइवर थे एसिड अटैक सर्वाइवर चेस किया था, उसमें से कुछ सर्वाइवर ऐसे थे जो पूरी ज़िंदगी नहीं देख सकते हैं, जो एक आंख से देख सकते हैं एक आंख से नहीं देख सकते हैं। तो उस टाइम पे यही रियलाइज़ हुआ कि ये बहुत, और कुछ यंग लोग बॉय गर्लफ्रेंड्स बनाते हैं, ये टाइम एक अलग होता है, सब करते हैं अपनी लाइफ को इन्जॉय करते हैं, तो कुछ लड़के मिल के ये कैंपेन स्टार्ट किया है, तो हम उनके साथ मिलके क्यों ना खड़े हो। तब हम लोग साथ में खड़े हुए और उसके बाद गए, उसी टाइम रिजल्ट आया सुप्रीम कोर्ट का कि ऐसे खुलेआम एसिड नहीं बिकना चाहिए, और दोनों को ही स्पेशली बुलाती थी और जहाँ जा रहे हम दोनों ही इंटरव्यू के लिए जाते थे, और उस गया और ना उन्होंने मुझे कुछ कहा ना मैंने उनसे कहा, और वो भी हिचकिचा रही हूँ अब क्योंकि मैं तो बहुत डर रही थी कि ये सर है और उसके बाद ये सारी चीज़ें। लेकिन उसके बाद वो बहुत सारे लड़के रहते थे घर में और मैं अपने घर चली गई थी, मैं अकेली लड़की उनके घर पे रहने लगी थी। 3 घंटे का था, 3 घंटे मुझे जाने में और आने में ऑफिस में लगते थे। तो उन्होंने कहा कि अब आप यहीं पे रह के काम में ही फिर वो सारी चीज़ें और प्यार व्यार ये सब चीज़ें हो गया। और उसके बाद फिर उस हुआ कि जब मैं अपने घर गई पहली बार तो उन्होंने मैंने मैसेज डाला कि आज कैसा लग रहा है, तो नहीं लग रहा है। उसके बाद फिर मैं लगा कि नहीं सच में हम दोनों को प्यार हो गया है, और फिर हम दोनों ने एक दूसरे को कह दिया कि दूसरे के बिना।
लक्ष्मी एंड आलोक हैव डिसाइडेड नॉट टू गेट मैरिड, दैट दे आर गोइंग टू लिव टुगेदर फॉर एवर, और ये सोसाइटी का जो कन्वेंशन है वो उन्हें नहीं करना है। फैमिलीज को भी ये बात पता है और वो लोग इस बात से खुश है?
पूरी दुनिया को पता है, पूरी दुनिया मेरी फैमिली को पता है इस बात का, और मुझे खुशी भी है क्योंकि मैं एक ऐसे बैकग्राउंड से बिलोंग करती हूँ, मुझे वैसी चीज़ है बहुत इम्पॉर्टेंट चीज़ है। बट लेकिन जब आलोक ने मुझे रियलाइज़ कराया कि शादी के बाद घूंघट खोलेंगे तो लोग तुम्हें देखेंगे, वो मुँह दिखाई होगा, ये सारी चीज़ें होगी, तुम्हें पैर छूना होगा, मैं बिल्कुल मुक्त करता हूँ, तुम्हें अपनी लाइफ जीनी है, बांध के नहीं रखना चाहता हूँ, तुम्हें मेरे साथ जब तक रहना है जैसे रहना है, जरूरत नहीं है। जब भी प्यार होता है तो हमें कानून नज़र नहीं आता है, फैमिली नज़र नहीं आती है, दोस्त नज़र नहीं आते, बस। तो वही चीज़ है कि जब प्यार होता है तो फिर उसके बाद टकरी चीज़ें क्यों नज़र आती है। तो प्यार से जब एक साथ हुए तो प्यार से अलग भी तो हो सकते हैं, प्यार से। तो है कि हम क्यों, हमें लगता है कि हमें डिसाइड करना है, हमें साथ में रहना है, तो हम किसी ऐसी के साथ में नहीं रख सकते हैं। हम खुश हैं, ऐसा नहीं है कि शादी बहुत बुरी चीज़ है, शादी अपनी जगह है, हम
आपने एक रास्ता चुना है जो आपको लगता है सही है और आपने अपने जीवन साथी को मान लिया, और इस जीवन साथी के साथ साथ आपकी ज़िंदगी में एक छोटी नन्ही परी आई जिसका नाम है पीहू। हमें थोड़ा
पीहू अभी 2 साल की हो गई है, वो बिल्कुल अनप्लान्ड थी और बिल्कुल भी नहीं, पर लकली वो हमारे जीवन में आ गई। उससे ऐसा भी हो गया क्योंकि आलोक और मेरे बारे में कभी हम कस ही नहीं करते थे, या हम दोनों एक दूसरे से बात ही नहीं कर पाते थे एक दूसरे को जानने के लिए, जब भी हमें पता चलता था कि हमें क्या पसंद है और क्या पसंद नहीं है। तो पीहू के आने के बाद फिर हम लोगों ने थोड़ा करना स्टार्ट किया, बहुत मज़ा आने लगा, पीहू के वजह से बहुत सारी चीज़ें होने लगी घर में, घर घर भी लगने, एक्टिविज़म और वही सारी चीज़ें, भाग दौड़ यही सब रहता था। लेकिन अब ऐसा भी हो गया कि पीहू,
अरे वाह कैसे,
जब वो 7 मंथ की थी तब से ही वो ट्रैवल करती है मेरे साथ, आज फिर साथ नहीं आई है, नहीं तो वो मेरे साथ हमेशा ट्रैवल करती है। वो बहुत अच्छी अच्छी चीज़ें, मतलब कोई भी वैसी चीज़ें होती है उसके अगेंस्ट लड़ती है। वो है 2 साल की लेकिन हरकतें बिल्कुल 5 साल, वो एक्स्ट्रा ही मुझे लगती है कि हो गई है। और वैसे उसका नाम प्यार से पीहू है, और SHE, एकदम सिंपल सा नाम, और लोग पूछते हैं कि इसका मीनिंग क्या है, वो एक लड़की है, इससे बड़ा मीनिंग आपको क्या चाहिए।
वाह वाह, शी से हम बात करेंगे, शीरोज़ के बारे में। शीरोज़ इज़ अ कैफ़े इन आगरा, ओनली एम्प्लॉयज़ एसिड अटैक विक्टिम्स, इट इज़ एन इनिशिएटिव बाय ऑल ऑफ देम टुगेदर, लक्ष्मी और एंड इट्स अ पे एज यू लाइक कैफे, सो यू गो देयर एंड यू लाइक द सर्विस टू पे एज मच एज यू वॉन्ट। इट्स गेनिंग अ लॉट ऑफ पॉपुलैरिटी एंड आई थिंक इट्स to come and interact with the acid victims and get to know more about them, and also an opportunity for them to have dignity with no fear and their own place.
इसके बारे में मैं थोड़ा सा बताना चाहूँगी कि जैसे जॉब नहीं मिलता था, बहुत प्रॉब्लम हो रही थी, लोग जानते थे कि एसिड अटैक क्या है, डोमेस्टिक वायलेंस क्या है, लेकिन कोई ये नहीं जानता था आज से 4 साल पहले कि एसिड अटैक, वही लोग जानते थे कि जिसके ऊपर एसिड अटैक हुआ है, और इसमें ये कोई मुद्दा भी नहीं था, इसमें कोई बातचीत नहीं थी इसमें। तब हम लोगों ने इतना सारा कैंपेन किया और जब बहुत सारे सर्वाइवर एक साथ इकट्ठे हुए तो बड़ा प्रॉब्लम था। एक तो लड़की को कोक से ही बोझ माना जाता है हमारे देश में, और उसके बाद जब वो बड़ी होती है और उसके साथ अगर कोई भी क्राइम हो जाए तो वो और बड़ी बोझ कहलाती है, शादी कैसे होगी, ये चीज़ें हैं। तो वही चीज़ निकल के आई कि क्या करना ऐसा चाहिए कि जैसा हो कि वो अर्न कर सके, अपने पैरों में खड़ी हो सके, तब समझ में आया कि एक हम लोगों ने क्राउड फंडिंग की और इसके बाद आगरा में ऑलरेडी दो सर्वाइवर थी, दोनों माँ बेटी थी, स्पेस मिल गया आगरा में। तो हमारा मेन मकसद ये था कि अवेयरनेस बिजनेस से ज़्यादा क्रिएट किया जाए, लोगों को समझ में आए कि एसिड अटैक है क्या, एसिड अटैक के बाद होता क्या है, सर्वाइव क्या कंडीशन होती है। तो उस वक्त में फिर हम लोगों ने वो कैफे सिर्फ स्टार्ट इसलिए किया था कि उसको देख, लकली वो इतना चल गया कि आज इसके ऊपर 40-50 डॉक्यूमेंट्रीज बन गई है और कैफे है जिसे खुद एसिड अटैक फाइटर्स रन कर रही है, इससे पहले ऐसा कोई कैफे नहीं था। और वो सिर्फ एक कैफ़े ही नहीं, बहुत छोटा सा स्पेस है, उसमें क्राफ्ट की चीज़ें रखी हुई है और जब आप वहाँ पे आएंगे आपको लगेगा ही नहीं कि वहाँ पे कोई सर्वाइवर काम कर रही है, आपको एकदम वैसे ही कैफ़े के ही तरह लगेगा, सब कुछ मेंटेन रहेगा। तब वहाँ पे जब अखिलेश यादव जी जब वो वहाँ पे आए उन्होंने देखा, तब उन्होंने एक स्पेस हमें लखनऊ में भी दिया, फिर वहाँ पे एक लकली एक कैफ़े उदयपुर में भी स्टार्ट हो गया, अभी हमारे 3 कैफ़े हैं।
सो टू मैनी मोर शीरोस।
और हम लोग मेन हमारा मकसद यही है कि हम लोग रिहैबिलिटेशन पे काम, अगर किसी भी क्राइम को रोकना हो तो रिहैबिलिटेशन इज़ मस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट। इसलिए पहले बताया कि कोई क्राइम करता है आपके ऊपर तो आपको सिर्फ हार्म पहुंचाता है क्योंकि उसका ईगो हर्ट होता है, देना चाहता है, वो आपको पूरा नहीं मिटाता है, आपके सपनों को ख़त्म कर देता है। तो इसीलिए शीरोज हैंगआउट की सर्वाइवर्स जब आती हैं तो वहाँ पर ऐसा है कि आपको जो करना है वो हम पूरा करेंगे, जो भी। आज हमारे साथ रितु भी, मेरे साथ रितु भी आई है और शिरोज मेरी है।
वेलकम रितु,
और
राउंड ऑफ अप्लॉज फॉर रितु टू।
और जिसका जो भी सपना है, जैसे रूपा का ड्रेस डिज़ाइनर बनने का सपना थी और उसके बाद हम लोगों ने वहाँ पे एक स्पेस उसको दिया कि वो अपना ड्रेसेस तैयार करती है और वहाँ पे वो लगाया है। ऐसी जिसका जो जो सपना है उस सपने को हम लोग पूरा करने में लगे हैं और वो एक हम लोग सर्वाइवर्स को ढूंढ के निकाल रहे हैं और उनके रिहैबिलिटेशन पे काम कर रहे हैं ताकि गवर्नमेंट कानून को पता चल सके कि एक्चुअली में जो प्रॉब्लम है उसको, क्योंकि आज खुद सर्वाइवर्स को आप देखेंगे कोई डरता नहीं है, किसी को किसी से कोई डर नहीं है, खैर सब लोगों ने कोई फेस कवर करके नहीं चलता, एकदम बिंदास रहते हैं और एकदम माहौल है। तो अच्छा लगता है कि हम लोग सक्सेस हुए हैं सिर्फ आप लोगों की वजह से,
आपकी आप खुद की इनर स्ट्रेंथ से। थैंक यू सो मच लक्ष्मी फॉर बीइंग विद अस हियर टुडे, इट इज़ माय टॉक्ड विथ यू एंड टू आई एम श्योर ऑल ऑफ यू ऑल आर एक्सट्रीमली इंस्पायर्ड बाय लक्ष्मी स्टोरी एंड चॉइसेस फॉर शीरोज आर ओपन। किसी को भी करनी है तो लक्ष्मी से बात करिएगा प्लीज़, क्योंकि शीरो ये एक मौका है कि हम एसिड अटैक विक्टिम्स को रिहैबिलिटेट कर पाए इसके थ्रू।
बिल्कुल, मैं इसके सॉरी मैं इस चीज़ के लिए, हम लोग ये नहीं चाहते हैं कि पूरे इंडिया में हो, हम लोग सिर्फ कुछ जगहों पे चाहते हैं कि कैफ़े हो, सिर्फ कुछ जगहों पे कि हम लोग रिहैबिलिटेट। अलावा अगर मतलब अगर आप लोग सपोर्ट करना चाहते हैं कि हम लोग एक ऐसा सेंटर बनाना चाह रहे हैं कि एक आगे बढ़ के आए और सर्वाइवर्स को सपोर्ट कर सकते हैं, कि एक ऐसा ट्रीटमेंट सेंटर की है कि अपना ट्रीटमेंट करवाए, एक उनका सेंटर हो स्पेशल सेंटर, उसके लिए हम लोग तैयारी कर रहे हैं क्योंकि बहुत कैसे मदद कर सकते हैं, तो आप उस प्रोजेक्ट में हम लोगों की हेल्प कर सकते हैं तो बहुत अच्छा होगा। थैंक यू सर।
और हम ये उम्मीद करेंगे कि ऐसा वक्त हो कि हमें कोई एसिड अटैक विक्टिम्स ही ना हो,
जो सबसे अच्छा होगा। क्योंकि मैं हमेशा ऐसे ही करती हूँ, सॉरी कि हम लोग विक्टिम नहीं है, क्योंकि मैं इस हूँ और मैं लड़ती हूँ इस वर्ड के खिलाफ, कहीं पे भी होती हूँ कैसे भी होती हूँ, क्योंकि हम लोग एज अ सर्वाइवर है, हम सर्वाइव कर रहे हैं क्योंकि हमें विक्टिमाइज किया जाता है और हम विक्टिमाइज होते हैं, हमें खड़े हो चुके हैं, आज हम अपने आप को ले के चल रहे हैं, तो मतलब नहीं है, सिंपल सी बात है।
सर्वाइवर्स, भगवान करे कि कोई एसिड अटैक ही ना हो।
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल,
थैंक यू वेरी मच। ओके, ऑल राइट, वी विल बी डूइंग अ क्यू एंड ए विद लक्ष्मी आफ्टर द अवार्ड्स।
थैंक यू सो मच लक्ष्मी फॉर मेकिंग इट ऑल द वे, एंड थैंक यू मानसी। Karan on stage to hand out the awards for all the lovely ladies and achievers that are here tonight. Also, I'm going to just invite one by one on stage our special guests to also give us. So, to start with, in fact, I should have asked Lakshmi to stay on stage for a moment. If I could have you back, and if I could have Malaika Khan on stage to also give the award. Thank you. stage to award Gauri Sawant, Zareen Khan. If you could please join us. A big hand of applause.
नहीं बोलूंगी 24 साल बाद मैं मेरे बड़े पापा को मिली हूँ। मैंने टीवी पे देखा मेरी बहन और मेरा भांजा आया है। इन्होंने कहाँ से देखा मुझे आज मिले। आज का दिन मेरे जिंदगी का सबसे बड़ा दिन है। मैं उम्मीद करती हूँ सभी ट्रांसजेंडर्स के फैमिलीज
Miss Malini, and could I request Rohit Roy to a very glamorous young lady. Stage as well, please, and I'd like to invite Madhu Shah to hand out this award. Lovely Farah Khan, I'd like to invite our last award tonight.
Stage for a group picture. We also have dinner and we're extremely sorry for the delay, but dinner in. But before that, let's have a group picture with all the awardees tonight, please.
For time. Stage. Gentlemen, I think you've been a fantastic audience. Stir did not play with their phones, was very actively involved. And credit also goes to our wonderful conversations tonight. So do join us for dinner and drinks. We hope to chat. I think for some of you who can stay back, we'll have a Q&A with Laxmi as you can meet with her over drinks. So do join us for the rest of the evening. Thank you.